Podwood Forecast!
I thought you were just like, you ever just lick your finger and smell it?
Go get my flamethrower.
Alright.
Avatar!
Let's just get right into it. Not even an intro, but
yeah.
No, welcome back.
James Cameron's Avatar.
No, M. Night Shyamalan's
Avatar. Yeah. We're going to be talking about... So we're not talking about the series. Talking about the movie.
The best movie
of all
time.
Because it's a lot better than the series.
Which actually, like, since watching the show, I still haven't watched the movie.
I refuse.
But I've seen YMS's review, and, like, after watching the show, it's just that much more painful.
I've seen a lot of clips of the movie, and it's... I won't watch it. I can't. I wouldn't be able to handle it.
Even just looking at the cast itself.
Yeah.
Like, no.
It's a bunch of little, like, white teenagers. It's
and, like, all the bad guys are Indian or whatever.
Yeah, and the firebenders need fire to actually firebend. They can't just produce it.
Oh, yeah.
Like, they walk around with torches so that they can... It's so dumb.
What's the point? Well, anyways.
Wow, we just really, like, into that.
We're welcome to the Podwood Forecast. I'm Clifford.
I'm Mitchell, and this is part two of our show swap.
Yeah, I just realized that we don't do a good job at, like, introducing ourselves, so, like,
yeah.
We apologize for any, like, newcomers that have jumped in and had a hard time figuring out who was who. So I'm Clifford, and he's Mitchell.
The one with the better voice is Mitchell. That's me.
Wow, okay.
The funny one is Mitchell.
Well, I hope you guys have
enjoyed. The big idiot is Clifford.
I hope you guys have enjoyed listening to this podcast, because I'm hereby resigning. I'm firing Mitchell and just continuing the show by
myself. Start my own podcast and you'll lose all your viewers.
Oh, gosh. No. I'm the one with the YouTube channel.
I would be awful podcasting by myself.
I don't know.
I feel like I can talk a lot, but I feel like you... keep me from going too far off topic, because I get really, like, ADD
sometimes.
And I'm like, oh, this and that, but you'll be like, anyways, let's dial it back.
Yeah.
But
well, let us know what you like about the podcast, and you can do that by going to Apple Podcasts and giving us a rating and review. And people still haven't done this, but if you leave a rating and review,
I love thinking about listening to this and just laughing, because every week we're just like, still no reviews, guys. Like, where is everybody?
I don't know. I mean, I know,
so funny.
I know it's kind of conceited to say, but is that the word I want? Like, prideful or whatever.
Conceited is right.
Yeah.
We're freaking awesome.
But, you know, it's a good way. I know we have some listeners. I know you're out there.
Yeah,
I know we're not the biggest podcast in the world, but if you guys want to help us out, it seriously does help us by leaving a rating and review, because that helps our podcast get recommended to other people. So, if you like the podcast, just take a few minutes out of your day, go to Apple Podcasts, write a rating and review, and in return, we'll make you famous, and we'll give you a shout out on the next episode and read your review, and and we'll give you money too. No.
Wow.
No. So, yeah. So, last episode, we talked about my favorite show growing up, Robin Hood. It's a very special show. If you haven't checked it out, you totally should, which I don't know why you would start. This is part two of the episode, so I don't know why you would start with here.
Yeah,
so.
It's weird because it's technically part two, but they can't act as episodes on their own. But it is part of a thing we're doing. So for context, if you are someone who skipped to the first episode for some reason, so... me and Clifford did this thing where we both chose one of our favorite shows. And so, for instance, last episode we talked about the BBC series Robin Hood. I had never watched that. Clifford had never watched The Last Airbender. Yeah. And The Last Airbender was my favorite show growing up, and it still is just my favorite show in general. And BBC Robin Hood it's not his all-time favorite show now, but it was his favorite, and it still holds a place in his heart very dearly. So they're both three seasons, so it just seemed ideal. So we both we're like, okay, you watch that show and I'll watch this show, and then we'll get together and talk about it. And that's what we're doing here. We talked about Robin Hood the last episode, and we got my thoughts on that since it was my first time watching. In this episode, we're going to hear what Clifford thought of Last Airbender. And I'm kind of interested because...
Airbender, the last Avatar.
Yeah, and I'm interested because everyone I know who grew up with it still loves it and even thinks it holds up today, and it's still my favorite show. Some nostalgia, but even going back to rewatch it, I still really love it. And I am even more impressed with a lot of aspects of it now that I know a bit more about like the process of making shows and writing and world building and focusing on stuff like that. I'm still really impressed by it, but I am excited to hear thoughts from someone who didn't grow up from it to see how well it holds up without nostalgia and like a new fresh perspective from someone who didn't really watch shows like that growing up, and just to see how that is. And
Which I guess there is some debate about this, but I do consider Avatar Last Airbender to be an anime.
Yeah.
And no, I didn't really watch shows like that.
I call it an anime inspired cartoon.
Okay.
Because it's not made, I don't know actually. I mean, there's a lot of like Japanese cultural like stuff in it and the language and what they write, but I feel like I don't know. I should have researched this, but I know it was Nickelodeon.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, Cartoon Network had Dragon Ball Z, and that was Japanese. So
yeah, and like my family didn't have TV, like television at the time, no cable or anything. Which I guess the show like around 2003.
Let me look.
Is that when it's? I'm pretty sure that's when it started. Definitely didn't have any TV then. My parents weren't big fans of it because...
It aired in February 21st, 2005 was the first episode.
Oh, okay.
So it's not like the oldest thing, but it was like pretty early. I would have been 10.
Which that's interesting that it came out in 2005 because even before then, my family, we didn't go to movie theaters either. And the reason why is because my parents... Well, my family, of course, we were all raised Christian. I'm still a Christian.
Sorry, I was laughing. I'm laughing because keep going. I'll get to this later. It's relevant.
But my parents were kind of pretty protective. About all I ever really watched as a kid was family-friendly movies, Christian movies, shows, stuff like that.
Yeah.
Old shows. That's why I'm such an old soul. So we didn't watch TV, and so I wasn't up to date. It was around 2005 that I watched my first ever movie in theaters.
Really?
Wow. I was 11 years old and watched The Chronicles of Narnia, The Lion, Witch, and Wardrobe, December 9th, 2005. Wow. Well, actually, I don't think it was that exact date. That's just when the movie came out.
My earliest movie theater memories are seeing Return of the King and... My parents took us to see Lord of the Rings every Christmas.
I wasn't even able to watch Lord of the Rings until after I turned 13.
I was super young. Because we
had the PG-13 rule.
I don't really remember seeing like the first two because I was really young, but I pretty much remember seeing like Return of the King at least. And
I watched the cartoons when I was a kid. I was allowed to watch those.
I did watch those too. I remember them being really weird.
Yeah, they are.
But I was obsessed with Lord of the Rings as a kid, obviously, and still am. So
yeah, so obviously when Avatar was popular, I wouldn't have been able to watch it. Mostly, I think my parents would have been okay with me watching it.
Yeah.
It's just we didn't have TV, and so like I didn't know anything about it.
It gets pretty like mature for a Nickelodeon show later on, so I wouldn't have been surprised if you were a kid watching and some scenes they were like
Well, at 11 I would have been fine.
Oh, okay, good. Yeah.
Like if I could watch Chronicles of Narnia, I would
consider it kid friendly.
Yeah.
It's like as mature as I would like.
I wish shows were like that. Yeah. More often, because like I wish kids shows took chances like Avatar Last Bender did.
Yeah.
Which I guess that comes to like how I feel about the show.
Just jump into
I said in the last episode that I was really excited about doing this episode. Well, we didn't know that this was going to be two episodes. We were going to try and do it in one episode, but of course we are incapable of
we talked about Robin Hood a lot more than we thought we would. So
and we'll see how this goes, but at first I was excited because I was excited to talk about Robin Hood, but after watching Avatar The Last Airbender, I was just excited to talk about Avatar.
Good.
So it was a combination of both of them. And so I'm really excited about doing this. Awesome. I'm a big fan now of Avatar, The Last Airbender.
Water. Earth. Fire. Air. Long ago, the four nations lived together in harmony. Then, everything changed when the Fire Nation attacked. Only the Avatar, master of all four elements, could stop them. But when the world needed him most, he vanished. 100 years passed, and my brother and I discovered the new Avatar, an airbender named Aang. And although his airbending skills are great, he has a lot to learn before he's ready to save anyone. But I believe Aang can save the world.
Of course,
it's obviously not my number one show of all time, but I think, Mitch, wait, he just left. Well, I guess I didn't have to fire him.
You'll have to add some stock, like door slam or something. Yeah. I was going to slam your door, but I didn't want to be rude and get
like
the cops
I did
called.
For the Mumford and Sons episode. Yeah. When you got acted like you were mad. And
I did
like,
actually get a
glass breaking.
No, I mean, I honestly, when I recommended it to you, I know you've watched like some anime shows and stuff, but I didn't know how up your alley this show would be. I just gave it to you kind of as a risk. Because I was like, yeah. I know it's pretty childish at first, but I was like, it gets pretty like intense and like mature for a kid's show. I was trying to like, because I could, in my mind, I was like, he's going to watch like the first few episodes and be like, this is like.
No, really I was childish. Committed. I but, knew I was going to watch the whole thing.
Yeah,
no
but I was, I'm almost.
Which I didn't tell
it's hard,
you.
It's hard to tell how someone's going to react to something you love if they didn't like grow up with it.
Yeah.
And part of me was like, what if he like hates it? And then I realized it's bad.
Yeah.
But no, I was still excited to recommend it. But a lot of shows you love are pretty drastically different from like a show like this. So I was interested to see if you would like it. And I wouldn't have been like surprised if you were like, it's okay. But I'm glad to hear that you liked it a lot.
Yeah, and I don't know if I mentioned this before, but there was a separate time, maybe a year or so ago, where I attempted to watch the show. Because it's not really available to stream anywhere, so I tried watching it on Watch Cartoons Online.
Oh, right, yeah.
And I watched the first episode, and I was a little taken aback of the childishness of the show, but
it's definitely...
I remember thinking like, oh, but this is kind of charming, you know,
totally.
But then I got distracted somehow and I didn't go back to it until we had this little challenge.
That's how I am with shows a lot, where like I'll start something and I'll just forget about it. But yeah, it's definitely interesting to see how the tone of the show evolves. Cause even when I rewatched it, I was like, wow, this is a lot more like, loud and comedic focus and stuff than I remembered, but as it goes on, it's such a gradual incline with the tone, and it's kind of cool that it starts out like that but gets to be so much more. And I think that's what's really satisfying about the show for me. Mm-hmm. Is like it starts out as this thing and it's like, oh, it doesn't, you know, it's a fun show, it doesn't seem like that big of a deal, and then it's like really intense stuff later on and really mature themes, and just the way like the show evolves, you don't really like when I rewatched it on I got the series on Blu-ray and I was rewatching it a while ago for fun, and there were some episodes where I was like, I'm kind of like surprised that this was on Nickelodeon.
Well, I think it's because
it's never to the point to where I'm like, this shouldn't have been on Nickelodeon.
I think we
but
underestimate how much kids can take, honestly.
Yeah, it's not even that like I don't think kids could take it. I would let my like 10-year-old watch this easily, but I'm just surprised because Nickelodeon has never really had a show like this that's like an ongoing plot that gets pretty serious, and because it's, you could not just pick any episode of the show and just watch it. Like, it's a show you need to watch from the start because there is an important overlying plot in character development,
even though it's still like episodic in structure.
Yeah. Usually seasonal structure, because each season kind of has its own thing, but there's still like an overarching like thing, a goal. There's a goal for the whole series, but lots of adventures throughout.
Yeah.
And Yeah, just like with Nickelodeon, it's like shows like Fairly Odd Parents and SpongeBob, where it's strictly episodic. There's not really a plot. It's just each episode is its own thing. So it was really weird. It was always really cool to have Nickelodeon have a show like that. And it's, and aside from Korra, which is a Last Airbender like sequel, they still haven't ever really had like a serious show like that.
I wouldn't know. I haven't really kept up to date.
I watched Nickelodeon like constantly, and it was always your SpongeBob's, your Fairly Odd Parents, you know, stuff like that. They, but Airbender, that the reason it caught me as a kid was because I was like, oh, this is like something I need to keep up with. And it was cool. It was like one of the first shows I remember being like invested, that in like Teen Titans, where Teen Titans isn't as much of like an overarching plot as Last Airbender, but they always had like multi-part things, like like multiple of those that were really compelling. And I started loving shows like that, and I got really into Airbender. And it was when it was airing on Nickelodeon, so I would have to watch a new episode every week and stuff like that. And it was super cool. But yeah, it's not like it's too dark for Nickelodeon, but or kids in general. But it was definitely just cool to see something that took itself seriously.
Yeah, it was stretching the border for sure. Yeah, and so so my impressions of like when I first started watching it was, you know, I was a little cynical, but still like open-minded.
That's kind of what I expected. I was kind of like, he's probably going to like not be into it at first, and then eventually.
Because, like I said, I was taken aback at how, like, I knew it was a kid's show, but I didn't realize like how, like at the beginning, like how much so it was going to seem at the beginning.
Yeah.
Like, I remember watching it.
The bad guy got dumped with a bunch of snow and everyone's laughing.
The guy lost all his cabbages.
That becomes, like, funny. Yeah. I love that.
Yeah, it's like an ongoing meme or something in the show.
What kind of slum do you think this is?
Oh, my cabbages! My cabbages!
You're gonna pay for this!
My cabbages! My cap!
Oh, forget it!
So much later in the show, and it's just along it's so
with
funny.
Foam mouth guy, which I didn't.
It's
think,
okay.
I didn't think
the
he was
first
funny,
time.
Honestly.
I thought the first time it was like kind of funny. But
first time he did it, I was like, "What the?"
Yeah, it was. So,
are you okay?
I actually like laughed the first time, but when they kept bringing it back, I was like, "All right."
I actually remember. I'm pretty sure I remember seeing GIFs of it.
Like
before ever seeing this show.
I think the reason it's weird is because like the animation of it is weirdly like smooth. It's like woo, like it's like the animation of it is like has so many more frames than everyone else around him.
It's just like, man, it's calm down.
It was funny the first time, but I was like, it doesn't.
And then
need
the second time they brought it back in like season two or something, and then he's like, oh, okay.
Yeah.
It's like, was anyone watching that I did that?
Right.
And it was just kind of, it's kind of cringe, bro.
Oh, God.
Sorry. I hate
you're going to lose
that,
viewers.
Oh, no. Please come back. Yeah. Because apparently they're like within the Avatar fandom, there's people that love Foam Mouth Guy, but people don't know what we're talking about who haven't seen the show. So I apologize.
I never I don't know. It's funny. I was just like, okay, that was a joke, but it's funny to me that there's like people who like love him. I'm like, it's just like a gag.
Yeah,
it's not really anything. Like, I think the first time it's done, it's like funny, but it's not like a part of the show I would ever like think of.
Yeah.
The thing about this show too is I still genuinely like, sometimes it has like that kid show humor where it's like, that was I like, chuckled a bit, but sometimes it was genuinely funny. It's definitely, I like the serious, I think it pulls off serious more than comedy, but still, especially when Toph comes in, I think she's actually really funny, like consistently.
Funny. She's one of my favorite characters.
Early on, the humor is a little too like lighthearted, but I think the humor becomes a lot more funny later on.
Yeah.
What's one part? Just like weird things where I can't remember. It's a very vague in my memory, but I'm gonna try to spell it out. But they're like all in a city at one point, and Sokka, I think it's Sokka, is just like annoyed, and he's just like, everyone else like leaves him, and he's just like angry and standing there, and he just looks down, and there's just like a duck there, and it honks at him, and that's it. And he just like, and it's just like funny to me for some reason. He just like stares at it and doesn't react. And
a lot
just
of it, yeah, a lot of it is very genuinely funny.
It's not a lot of like slapstick humor. It's just a lot of like funny dialogue and character interactions.
Yeah.
And,
I will say
like,
that
especially Sokka in the desert when he sees the explosion and he's like high on the cactus juice
mushroom.
And he's like, I like when Sokka is like blasted on the cactus juice. Yeah. And he's like, oh, a friendly mushroom. And he like, go, I don't know that me and my sister still quote that where he's like, guys, drink the cactus juice. And he's like going into the scene. He's like, oh, it's so good. It's the quenchiest. And it's like the filter's all weird and he's just crazy.
Nothing's quenchier. It's the quenchiest.
Okay, I think you've had enough.
Who lit Toph on fire?
Me and my sister still say the quenchiest. Like, oh, it's the quenchiest.
that's pretty
it's
great.
It's a very quotable show.
Yeah, and there are a lot of good. There's a lot of good funny parts and funny parts. The show does have my least favorite thing about like some and okay. I'm just gonna get all the bad stuff out of the way because there really is the good outweighs
the
bad.
There really is just so much crap to talk about.
No, there's just a few like a handful of things. Yeah. Are sometimes prevalent in the show or just things that just kind of went away as the show went on. But one of my least favorite things whenever I see it in anime is that those parts where it's like supposed to be really funny and really like quirky and like the animation style changes to that like simplified, really stupid looking
overexpressed kind
of
thing.
Yeah, overexpressed and like
it doesn't happen a lot, but I honestly kind of like that.
I don't.
I know it's a trope, but
it takes me out of the moment so much. Like I hate. Really? I know they did it a lot in like Helsing Ultimate. And
when it's done too much, I don't like it.
Whenever it happens, like even if it's not done and like as much,
yeah,
that just makes those scenes just stand out so much, and I don't like it. It's just so out of place because like this all of a sudden the character image changes and like it's. Like it has those weird sound effects, like whatever it is. It's just really goofy, and I always found those.
I feel like if it interjected with a serious moment, it would make me really mad. But it doesn't really bother me. But I think it's fair that it would bother people, and it makes sense because this is a really tropey anime thing to do.
Yeah,
and that's where like the anime inspiration. Speaking of which, I need to. Tell you what I was laughing at earlier because it's relevant to this now, but I googled is Avatar the Last Airbender an anime, and the first thing you see on Google, like the answer pops up right away, and it's like Avatar the Last Airbender is not an anime, semicolon, here's why. Avatar the Last Airbender is one of the greatest shows ever made. It tells a full story and it has one of the best endings ever. It's like that's why it's not anime, because it's one of the best shows ever.
What the heck? Is it like, saying that there aren't any good anime
shows?
Yeah,
I was like, the way it's worded, it made it sound like...
You never watched Death Note or One Punch Man?
An actual answer, though. Avatar The Last Airbender is animated, but it is not anime, but it is not Japanese, so no, it's not anime. It was produced by Nickelodeon, an American cartoon company. It was not created in Japan or produced by a Japanese studio, so technically it's not anime, although it derives a lot of Japanese culture.
I didn't know
So it was made, that. Like, in an American studio.
Okay,
but it's very anime inspired.
I don't feel like I don't feel like whether it's made in America or Japan really matters because it's a style.
Yeah,
but I don't know. Whatever.
Yeah, because anime technically means Japanese animation.
Okay,
and it's technically American animation, but it uses Japanese style as and culture as inspiration. But anime technically means it was like. Animated in Japan or something.
I feel like I remember seeing a lot of like Japanese names in the credits.
Castlevania, they call Castlevania an anime, but that's So I don't know. It's weird.
I think it is just a style.
It's a complex issue.
Yeah. Well, we'll get deep into it next episode.
I don't think I would fight anyone who calls it anime.
I mean this in the most positive way. It's like a diet anime.
Yeah,
like it's not like full-on anime, Because, like, the character designs and everything aren't, like, fully, like, you know, like, the edgy kind of sharp edges and everything.
Yeah.
Everything's a lot more smoother than in a typical anime.
Yeah, it visually looks pretty American with, like, the line art and stuff.
Yeah.
But, like, the action and some of the way the humor and especially, like, the moments you don't like, that's a very anime thing. Which I kind of agree. Usually I'm like, but it's not something that bothers me, but... It's not something I would, like, be offended by if, so, like, someone said, like, that annoys me, because there's a lot of things... I don't really watch anime that much. I've seen, like, 3 anime shows in my life.
Yeah, I'm the most, like, casual anime fan.
I've seen, like, Dragon Ball Z and some Gundam shows. But
Studio Ghibli.
I really, yeah, like those movies, but I don't watch it a lot, so I'm not, like, an anime master. I'm not an anime master, but
they're called weebs.
But
so, like, those weird cartoon moments, I just don't like them in any show, honestly. Fair. And so I just like them even less in that show, because, like, I was liking it so much, and anytime those moments come, I'm like,
and a lot of cartoon shows do that, I feel like, so.
Yeah, and I just had to remind myself, like, you know, this is Japanese inspired, and it's also a kid's show, so. And the other thing was that I also had to keep reminding myself that it's a kid's show, was that, like, you know, at least mostly during the first season, you know, like, not all the jokes are landing. We keep talking about the comedy aspects. Like, this is not really, it's not a comedy show.
Let's talk about all that first, because when we do get into
the serious parts of
it, that's when we'll actually start.
Yeah.
Probably going to take up the rest of the episode when we get into that.
Like, I love how the show is very lighthearted, and I love that about it. It's just like when you first start the show, not all the jokes are landing. Yeah. You know, so I'm watching it, and I'm like, it's funny. Whatever.
Yeah.
I mean, some of it
you're never
was,
really laughing out loud.
Yeah.
And there's only a few moments that genuinely.
A lot of it is very charming. And so, like, that's why I, like, stuck with the show, because, like, I liked the characters and I wanted to, you know, I wanted to watch them more. So, so all that didn't really have a huge effect on me. And also, you notice, like, at the beginning of the show, some of the, like, quality aspects are not as great.
Yeah.
The animation definitely improves as the show goes on.
Oh, yeah, totally.
And also the voice acting. Because I remember watching the first couple of episodes and like, especially for Aang at first, I remember thinking, like, oh, I would have delivered that line differently.
Yeah.
But of course, he's a kid actor or whatever.
I'm pretty sure, I think a female voices him.
Oh, I don't know.
I think. Let me check. I'm pretty sure.
I wouldn't be surprised. There's so many of those, like, kid, boy characters.
A lot of women voice act younger.
Yeah, like Rugrats. Why do I have a cut on my finger?
Yeah, what's wrong with you?
Like Rugrats, Tommy Pickle is voiced by a kid.
Yeah.
And I think, who's the red-haired kid on there? He's voiced by a girl.
Chucky,
yeah. I said kid. Tommy Pickle's voiced by a girl. Chucky's voiced by a girl. Both of the twins are voiced by a girl.
It's not showing up on IMDb, this series, for some reason, so...
I think it sounds like
a kid.
I'm
pretty sure it is, yeah. But, yeah, the voice actor... Let's just say the voice actor, because I'm too lazy to look it up, but...
He gets a lot better as the show goes on.
Especially in, like, the later seasons, when he has to have some serious moments, and when he's, like, getting mad at other characters or something. Like, I think he's really convincing when he's, like, distressed about something or stressed out.
Oh, yeah.
It's... Really, like, great. All the main characters, I'm glad none of the main characters ever had, like, bad voice actors, or, like, I feel like all their performances were great early on, you know, maybe not the best, but you can definitely see it improve.
Yeah.
And, like, especially, like, Zuko and Iroh.
Zuko, like, yeah, I'm actually pretty familiar with the voice actor for him.
I
recognized him right away. He was the voice for Jake Long in the show American Dragon.
Hey, I did it! Check me out! I'm the American Dragon!
Didn't know that, actually.
Yeah.
That's super obvious now that I think about
it. That's him. And also, this is just a weird random fact. So there's this Christian teen coming of age, not really coming of age, but, like, there's this Christian movie called Extreme Days.
Say cheese.
Road trip!
road trip. We wanted to surf, skate, and snowboard across California.
For the love of donuts, let's go!
It was now our time, and nothing could stop us.
And it's like this really funny, funny. It's like this about these group of guys that like graduated college and they're like on this road trip. It's just this like young adult road trip Christian movie, and he's actually one of the main characters.
Yeah.
I forget his name.
Dante Basco.
But he's also in the movie Hooked. Or Hook.
Oh,
with Robin Williams. He's the leader of the Lost Boys.
Oh, cool.
So he's actually he's like older as Prince Zuko. He's already like into his adulthood, so he just
makes
has
sense
that kind
he's
of voice.
Like he's an older character. I think he's 18 in the show or something. I can't remember.
Yeah, but like Hook, he was already a teenager, and that was like from the 90s. Yeah. So I was familiar with him, and I recognized his voice right away. And I really liked the spirit of Aang's voice, the voice actor.
Oh, yeah.
He just wasn't perfect right from the get-go.
Yeah.
And he definitely got a lot better as the show went on.
Definitely.
And I'm trying to think, as the show went on, a lot of that stuff got a lot better, a lot more improved. Even though there still were one or two episodes in the later seasons that still were kind of lame.
The later seasons have a couple more filler episodes than early on, I feel like. Because early on, they're really pushing it forward like with what's going on and got to get here. But the thing I at least appreciate, I'm pretty biased, so other people will totally disagree with me, and I won't fight them on it. And you may disagree as well. But for me, I never mind any of the filler episodes, and some of them I like especially the flashback episode where they, because a lot of shows do this episode, like for some reason
they always have their flashback episode
where it's like, hey, remember all this happened. But I love the way this show does it because it's done through like a play that they go to about and it's really funny. And
which apparently a lot of fans hate that episode.
Really? I think it's so funny.
I'm not saying I do.
I
thought it was funny.
Yeah, I'm talking quote unquote to those people. Like, really? Like,
what is wrong with all of you?
I think it's really enjoyable, and I love the way they make fun of Zuko's hair getting longer and stuff. And
I also love how Toph is played by this guy.
Yeah.
This big
Which
dude.
I think is a jab at one of the creators of the show, because Toph was originally supposed to be a big buff dude, and one of the creators was like, no. Like, no, 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 no. And so they made her like a younger girl, but one of them wanted Toph to be a big buff dude. So I feel like that was a jab at the original idea
that
of
is
Toph.
Pretty funny.
You can't find an earthbending master in the sky. You have to look underground.
Who are you?
My name's Toph, because it sounds like tough. And that's just what I am.
Wait a minute. I sound like a guy. A really buff guy.
Well, Toph, what you hear up there is the truth. It hurts, doesn't it?
Are you kidding me? I wouldn't have cast it any other way.
There's the beach episode in season 3. But I kind of like that episode because it has some it has some good character development. That's why I like when there is a filler episode and it's not really advancing important plot points. It's still, even if it only happens near the end or at like one point or another, I feel like there's always at least some kind of like important or interesting like character development or interaction.
Yeah.
And I think the show utilizes filler really well, because every show at least has some filler. You can't have every episode be super, super important.
Yeah.
Even like Breaking Bad at least had one filler episode, kind of like The Fly, but that's still a good episode.
Yeah, I love that episode.
So I think it utilizes it really well. There's not really, I can't really think of episodes. There are episodes I'm like, I don't care for it, but I never skip an episode when I rewatch it, because I feel like every episode serves an important purpose.
Yeah.
There's some like I don't love and I'm like, okay, like
this. There's one that I can definitely think of.
And I think you mentioned it to me. So
yeah.
Go ahead.
I still definitely am not a fan of, is it the second season or the third season? I just remember it being so jarring because the show, it must have been the second season, because the show was like getting
good. The third season, they're mostly in the Fire Nation.
Yeah.
Was it the Avatar Day one?
Yep.
Yeah.
Avatar so, Day. Mm-hmm. And like, it was, I just remember it being so jarring because the show was like, I had always been enjoying the show, but it was like actually getting good.
Yeah.
And then this episode comes out of nowhere. Mm. And I think I heard apparently it was written by one of the writers from like the earlier start of the show.
Yeah, which makes sense because it's just like kind of randomly more different.
Random and like very, very childlike, you know, and kind of pointless and not.
It's funny. Very like humor focused and like the plot of it is kind of like random and quickly paced and just kind of like happens. But I still, even though, kind of going back to my point where it's like, even though I don't think that's a great episode, it does still serve a purpose because I like that you get to see a part of this world, because throughout this show so far, it's like every mention of the Avatar, people think of the Avatar as like this hero and like everyone loves the Avatar as like a, I mean, they're like all like sad because it's like, where'd he go and stuff. But I like that you get to see a place that actually kind of hates the Avatar.
Yeah.
Because it shows like, oh, not every, it's realistic. It's like, oh, not everyone thinks the Avatar is like this supreme being and everyone worships the Avatar and loves them. It was kind of cool to see like a place, and it tricks you because it's like, oh, they're having a celebration, but it turns out it's a condemnation.
We hate him.
And I think it's kind of cool to see that, even though the tone of it isn't like super serious. But and I agree with you for sure. Like, I don't think if I did skip an episode, I probably would do that one. But I still like it because I think it's Kyoshi or one of the past Avatars where you kind of learn a bit about them. And
yeah, that was interesting. But it's literally like 1 minute in the episode.
Yeah, that's my problem with it, is like the important cool story aspects are like rushed.
Yeah.
And it just kind of like, it's really weird how it happens and stuff, because it's not really a thing that comes into play later very often. But
yeah,
it's still cool to like learn a little bit of lore, and you get a, and it's kind of like a world building episode in a way, just not done like in the most impressive of ways. But I agree. It's probably one of my least favorite episodes, but I still think it has like its purpose, because I think this show, what it does best is its world building, and they have a lot more of it later on, done a lot better with people that don't love the Avatar. But I think it was cool to introduce that at least. Because it wasn't something I thought about, but when I rewatched it, I was like, oh yeah, it's like kind of cool that we get to see a different side of the public, even if by the end of it, they all change their minds basically. But, but yeah, it's not good. It's a pretty like weak episode, but it still offers something, which is what I appreciate, is because every show has like some like lame episodes, but I at least appreciate that this one still, you still get something out of the lame episode, so it's not totally pointless. But
yeah,
that's basically all I have to say about that, really.
Yeah, well, let's continue our conversation. We are past due for a break. Sorry about that. It was 36 minutes. Gosh. Sorry to all of our advertisers that we definitely have.
Yeah.
Just
busting our door down.
Yeah. So go get some candy bars, and we'll be right back in a little bit. Yes. I know I say that, but the podcast continues on with a bunch of stuff in between.
Yeah.
So, all right. See you in a bit. Hey guys, so it's my turn to have my own ad right now for me. This is for me. So if you guys don't know already, I mean, some of you are already watching this on YouTube, so you already know. I actually have my own YouTube channel that I've been putting a lot of effort in and creative energy into, and it's called I'm Clifford Today. Basically, what I do on there is that I talk about Christian music mainly, and I review it, I talk about it, I make videos that are about it. So if you've always thought, like, man, Christian music just kind of sucks, and you want a YouTube channel that critiques it fairly, but also introduces some, maybe some good Christian music that you never heard of, then check my channel out. And also, I've got some, like, serious, like, essay-type videos where I talk about things having to do with Christian music. Like, for instance, I did a video on one of my favorite old Newsboys songs and the backstory behind it and how much it means to me. And then I also just recently started an essay series on a Christian metal band called As I Lay Dying. So a bunch of fun stuff. I also plan on talking about other things in Christian entertainment other than music. I already have a video on video games, Christians in video games. So, man, what is that about? So please check out I'm Clifford Today on YouTube, or you can type in youtube.com/I'm Clifford Today. Go check it out. And also, you'll always see Podwood Forecast episodes on there. Also, Mitchell shows up in a couple of my videos, and he will be a consistent guest on a lot of my videos. So that would be fun. You can see our faces instead of having to listen to us all the time. Okay, this ad is very long already, so I guess I'll talk to you guys. I don't know. Bye.
And so I sit here without ambition. I really need my Intellivision.
Hi, welcome back to the break. So
I started recording and Mitchell's like, wait, I gotta...
Sorry, someone told me they liked Picard and I had to yell at them. He's probably going to listen to this podcast.
Oh well, I mean, at least we have a listener.
So the first half of this was, we were kind of getting our critiques out of the way because obviously no show is really perfect, but now we're going to
get into the stuff. Yeah, I honestly don't really have any much else to say negatively.
Yeah, because which I mean, yeah, and your criticisms were totally fair and I even agree with you to an extent. But I mean, it's my favorite show of all time, but right. It's okay to acknowledge like some not perfect aspects of
right,
it, and that's
yeah,
okay.
Exactly.
And I'm okay with people not
nothing
loving
is
it
without reproach.
Yeah, and I'm okay with people not loving something as much as me, or liking or disliking something yeah, that I don't mind. It's totally fine.
I mean, it's totally fine. Even perfect films like The Joker is not with
a shut up. The ending scene makes me shake. Cinematic masterpiece.
The scene where they revealed that the girlfriend wasn't real. Oh man, I'm glad they even explained it to me that she wasn't
real.
Yeah,
I didn't really get
it. I didn't get it at first. Like, why didn't she recognize him when she went in the room? Anyways. Anyways, this is funny because I have a friend that he recently stated that The Joker is his favorite movie of all time. It's just so funny.
Oh, Lord on high. Bless his soul.
You're entitled to your opinion.
It's no one's favorite movie of all time. Anyways.
He might even listen to this podcast, so
I love you.
Much love to you. I mean, he craps on my on my movie opinions,
yeah,
too. So
it's okay.
Okay,
I have a quick interesting question about The Last Airbender. Let's get
fine,
back to that.
What?
No. I just want to see, because in my opinion, I want to see if you agree with this. I think this show, it's one of the rare shows that just continually gets better.
Oh yeah, I've already mentioned
like,
it.
First
on the
season's
show.
Great, but like the ending of season one is just like so good, and then that yeah, sets up for like the more seriousness with two, and then three is just like crazy.
Yeah,
and I'm curious if you're like, no, I think season two is better than three, or if you agree that each season is better than the last.
No, I think that season one is good. I think it's enjoyable. Mm-hmm. It's entertaining.
What do you think of the finale, though, with, like, the war?
I really was into that.
And Sokka's moon girlfriend.
Yeah.
His girlfriend
yeah,
is
my girlfriend
moon.
Turned into the moon.
Yeah.
My first girlfriend turned into the moon. That's rough, buddy.
He is
That's
really,
rough, buddy.
He is really, yeah.
This is one of my favorite line
That's
exchanges.
Rough, buddy. Dude, Zuko, I know we're bouncing all over the place, but Zuko, which we talked about this with Robin Hood, about Guy kind of joining them. I love aspects like
Dude,
that.
Dude, I'm going to write a fan fiction about Zuko and Guy of Gizmo. It's going to be so hot.
You made friends with your arch rivals too?
Yes. For most of my life, I felt misunderstood.
But that
I also lost my mother as a young.
Oh my gosh. But I think that aspect is so perfectly done in this show. The way it doesn't just happen and they're really weary and it's not like they're friends right away. It's done with such like reproach and like cautious, like he asks to join them and they're like, no, go away. And he's like, they show him like pacing and he's like, how do I want them to like me. It's, I mean, he's not actually saying that, but it's almost like comedic, but it's not,
it's really cute.
It's sad. but it's like sad. Because it's like, this is like his only hope, but they hate him. And he goes back, but then he gets scared because Toph is like, I'm going to go give him a chance. And then he accidentally burns her feet. And he's just like, no, I'm sorry. And you're just like watching it and you're like, oh, Zuko, no.
And it's just like feels he's trying to impress a girl, but he's just trying to impress a whole group of people.
You just feel so freaking bad.
Why aren't you saying anything? You once said you thought we could be friends. You know I have good in me.
There's no way we can trust you after everything you've done. We'll never let you join us. You need to get out of here. Now.
I'm trying to explain that I'm not that person anymore. Either you leave or we attack. If you won't accept me as a friend, then maybe you'll take me as a prisoner.
No, we won't! Get out of here and don't come back. And if we ever see you again, well, we'd better not see you again.
And it's like, it's stressful. And the way that he, when he finally joins, but everyone is still just like, I don't know.
They're mostly accepting, and except for Katara, which is, you know, granted.
Very reasonable.
I really like that dynamic where like everyone's like, oh, okay. But Katara's like, no, you think that you're cool, but you're not.
Yeah, like the way when they're all kind of hanging out one night and they all leave, but she goes up to him and like kind of confronts him. So and is like,
if you do anything, I'll kill you.
Yeah, basically. And
she's like,
it's so well done because so many shows would just like have them join and they're just cool and no problems. But it's like a slow, it's a slow development. Like he really has to earn his way into the group.
Zuko has like the best character arc ever.
He's
honestly
my favorite character in any TV show.
I would say he's my favorite. Like I love a lot of the characters, and I do. I would
all the
like
characters
to,
are great. Everyone has. An
I would
arc.
Like to talk about like all the characters and
yeah.
The show.
Let's start. Let's just do that. Let's talk about characters and like their pivotal moments and stuff.
Yeah, and Zuko. I think it's like universally agreed that he had like that his personal story is like the best.
Yeah, it's like freaking heartbreaking.
I love his whole the whole dynamic between him and Uncle Iroh.
Yeah, they're my favorite duo in the whole show. Like their dynamic and the way, and you know, whenever I watch a movie and there's like friends and there's like the one part where it's like, oh, they have to get mad at each other now, it always feels like forced. But
yeah,
the way they do it, it works better in TV shows, but the way it works with him and Iroh, it's crazy because it's so unexpected.
You brought this on yourself, you know. We could have returned together. You could have been a hero. You have no right to judge me, Uncle. I did what I had to do in Ba Sing Se, and you're a fool for not joining me. You're not going to say anything? You're a crazy old man! You're crazy, and if you weren't in jail, you'd be sleeping in a gutter.
And it's like these two people who you saw as villains when the show started. And then it's like you care about these two people and their relationship. This guy who really kind of just was a generic villain when the show started. But he develops so well, and you get to learn a lot of his backstory.
I think the reason why he seems like a generic villain
because you don't know his backstory yet.
Well, yeah, and also he's just like at first he's just this hot-headed teenager, you know, who's just angry.
And he is really doing one thing where, you know, you watch and it's like he's just going to kind of be the troublemaker throughout the show. Like he'll show up every now and then and cause a kerfluffle and then just leave.
He's like, if it wasn't for you meddling kids.
Yeah, he just kind of shows up to cause some trouble. He's trying to capture the Avatar to bring him back, and you think that's all it's going to be for the whole show. And that's what I love about this show, is it sets up things to where you're like, okay, I know where this is going to go, and then it doesn't. And it plays things out so untraditionally.
I think I sensed at some point in season one, I was like, okay, I feel like Zuko is going to have to end up being a good guy.
Yeah, because they kind of start developing him and sharing his backstory. Yeah. So you're like,
there's
why
way they would pay so much attention to him if he wasn't going to like switch.
Totally.
Which I predicted that. It wasn't annoying to me, though.
Yeah.
Because like, it's enjoyable to watch his whole progression. I love that episode, that like standalone episode, that where it's just him and in that village with that family. It's so original and unique.
I love moments like that, and it's heartbreaking too. And this is another thing I love about this show, is the way it has characters experience things that you as the viewer are also experiencing. Mm-hmm. For example, you know, I mean, it's at the beginning of every episode with like, then the Fire Nation attacked and they ruined everything. And you're so led to believe that Fire Nation equals bad. Yeah. Anyone who is in Fire Nation is bad. The first villains you see are Fire Nation. You're just watching. You're like, okay, Fire Nation is bad. But then as the show goes on, it's like, okay, Zuko is a person.
Yeah.
And you start to learn more.
Like,
okay,
oh, there's a guy who's Fire Nation, but like, he helped them.
And then you start being like, Iroh's never really doing anything bad. It's like, maybe he's nice. And then I think he has like one moment where he kind of fights the group a little bit.
But it's mostly just kind of like defensive. Maybe to protect Zuko or whatever.
It's really, he never like full on fights them, but there's like one moment where he kind of confronts them, like, because he has to, but he, that's still at a point where it's just like, oh, he's just the uncle of the bad guy.
Yeah. And you kind of realize later on, it's like, oh, Iroh was kind of a good guy from the beginning.
Yeah, exactly. You know? And you start, like the episode you mentioned, it starts humanizing Zuko. I mean, he's already really humanized by this point. I also love how when they have to go into hiding and him and Iroh, they cut their hair, and then his hair starts slowly like grows out throughout the show.
Yeah.
And I love when cartoons bother to do that. Like the character's hair is getting longer. And that happens with Sokka and like Aang at one point, and Katara, and you can see their hair get longer throughout the show and stuff. And I think that's super cool.
I never noticed them. I mean, now that I think of Katara,
with Sokka, because
remember,
he always had the shaved sides, but there's one point where it's like grown in.
Oh yeah.
Like later on, it's really subtle. And Katara's is like, it's more when she like has her hair down, you know, but it's really subtle. And I love when cartoons bother to do that. And it's cool to like see.
Or like Aang when that time where he was like unconscious for like a long time.
He wakes up and he has hair, but he keeps it so he can hide his arrow in the Fire Nation. It's just like lots of clever things. It's not just like, oh, one episode he has hair. It's like, it's established, oh, he was unconscious for a really long time, and that's why he suddenly has hair. It's not just like one episode. It's like,
usually in cartoon shows, you'll notice that they actually do kind of do this in Avatar. All the characters, they always have the same clothes because, you know, for kids, it makes them more recognizable.
Yeah, you have to have, like the iconic clothing and stuff. Yeah. But there are parts, like, in season three, they're, like, never in their usual attire, which I think is cool.
They switch it up a little bit. Because I did start to notice, I was like, oh, they're kind of wearing, like, the same clothes every day.
Yeah.
But they weren't afraid to just kind of, like, step out of that. But it was, like, integral for the plot, especially when they were in like Fire Nation. So they had to dress like Fire Nation people.
Yeah.
So that was just a little thing
there. Definitely. And with Zuko, more about like the humanizing Fire Nation element, like when he is hanging out with that family and they don't know he's Fire Nation.
Yeah.
And they kind of like are talking about Fire Nation and stuff. And
he's just like,
oh. Then there's like the point where they figure out he is, and he goes to them, and I think it's like the little girl or someone is just like, get away from me.
Yeah.
Not a step closer.
It's yours. You should have it.
No, I hate you.
After like all he's been with them, but then they just hate him after they learn he's a firebender, or not Fire Nation, but firebender, which I mean, same thing, but just that he's a firebender. They're like, no, get away from me. And I think that's such a good message. It's like, they were with him. They loved his presence. He was a really good person with them, but, oh, you're a firebender? No, don't talk to us anymore. You're a bad person.
Yeah, even after, like, saving their lives.
Yeah, he saves their lives, too, and then it just ends with him leaving, and it's so sad, but it's such a good message, I think, for kids to see in a show.
Yeah.
But, yeah, so that whole thing with Zuko, that's a great episode. I just think he has the best arc, just the way he starts, and he has one of the most satisfying... Like, he has a lot of the most satisfying moments, and he still consistently messes up, even when he is good, technically. But even when he becomes good, he kind of falls back into being bad again. It's like, it's interesting. Yeah. He's such like a well-written character, because even when he becomes good, it's not like, oh, he's just good now. It's not like just he's still
everything's all peachy from now on.
Yeah, there's still a lot of bad things that go down, and... It's just really cool, and he even has a moment with Iroh where it's like he betrays him, and he goes back to him later to like apologize, and he's just like not talking to him, and because Iroh's like in jail now because of him, and he just doesn't talk to him, and it's really brutal and really sad, and the whole thing with like him being the blue spirit is cool. He's the one who like, I can't remember like the one where Appa gets taken, and Appa like. And he gets to him, and that's kind of like one of the first moments where you're like, oh, he's like good now, as he decides to let Appa go, basically.
Yeah.
Which is really cool. Zuko does that for Aang in a way, because he's just like, yeah, I don't need to be living this lifestyle. And like, he still struggles because he needs his father's approval so bad that even when he gets to a point where he's like, I don't need this anymore, but he has a chance. He's like, oh, wait. If I brought this to my dad right now, the Fire Lord, and it's just so much temptation. And I love that he still struggles with that, even after he quote unquote gets over it, like capturing the Avatar for the Fire Lord.
Release him immediately.
It's not too late for you, Zuko. You can still redeem yourself.
The kind of redemption she offers is not for you.
Why don't you let him decide, Uncle? I need you, Zuko. I've plotted every move of this day. This glorious day in Fire Nation history, and the only way we win is together. At the end of this day, you will have your honor back. You will have Father's love. You will have everything you want.
Zuko, I am begging you, look into your heart and see what it is that you truly want.
You are free to choose.
It's just so cool, and I love the way the show wraps up with him being like the Fire Lord and stuff. It's just so satisfying and good. And
I love the moment where he reunites with Iroh.
Yeah. It's so emotional.
Yeah. I definitely teared up at that moment. That was like the most emotional part in the whole show.
Oh, totally.
For me,
yeah. Cause honestly, it's heartbreaking. And
Iroh,
cause he is his dad in a way, because his real dad is awful. And when they show how his dad is the one who gave him the scar by just like, they did an Agni Kai, like his father and his son did an Agni Kai, which for those who don't know, I don't know why you're listening to this if you don't like Avatar or know the show, but it's like basically like a duel, and he basically fights his son and just burns the crap out of his face during the fight because Zuko didn't want to fight his dad, but his dad just, burns his face, scars it for life.
I'm not raising a sissy of a kid.
Yeah, it's just so brutal, but it's crazy. But
Iroh
he's such
is definitely that replacement, and he's like, at first, like you said earlier, you're like, oh, Iroh, you don't realize that Iroh's like a good person.
Yeah,
at first he actually just seems like comic relief because he's just kind of
he's just kind of like the goofy uncle.
He's like, hey, Zuko, where's the tea?
Yeah,
would you like to play this
Pie
game.
Show.
Yeah, whatever. Pie show.
I need my White Lotus.
Yeah. But he definitely, once you get to know him more, you realize what he's all about.
Yeah.
Because he's obvious, you realize that he's not all about the whole like Fire Nation nationalism, all that stuff. He's really focused on trying to make Zuko a genuinely good person, and not be so wrapped up in trying to be trying to get the approval of his father and making him realize that he's a lot more than that.
And I love that you kind of learn a bit about him too. Like, I think it was the Dragon of the West or whatever they called him, like he was like a vicious general, and everyone is always like, you used to be great and like such a good warrior, and it's like interesting to like think of him like that because he's so lighthearted most of the time to think. And it's interesting when you learn a bit about his backstory and especially with his son. And that's another thing that makes their dynamic so good is they both fill like a hole in each other's souls because Zuko never really had a father. A real, like, he had a father, but he never had, like, a father figure. And Iroh's son died, like, a long time ago. And so they're uncle and nephew, but they're really, like, father and son. And they both fulfill, like, something that was lost. And there's, like, the scene where it shows Iroh up on the hill. And he's, like, having a memorial thing for his son. And he starts singing. And that's both... to establish like something about his son, but it's also a reference because the original voice actor for Iroh had died and that was the new voice actor. And so that was like for that voice actor, which is so sad, but it's really impressive because you can't even tell the difference.
You never notice. I didn't even know.
You probably could if you focused and like knew that, but the new voice actor did a great job.
I think
it was that. I'm pretty sure that's what it was, like the voice actor for Iroh. Maybe it was someone else, but I'm pretty sure it was like the voice actor for Iroh died.
Yeah, that's all right. There's nothing wrong with spreading misinformation. But that whole Zuko and Iroh is a great, great dynamic.
Yeah.
And I love that part of the show.
I don't need your wisdom right now, Uncle.
I'm sorry. I just nag you because, well, ever since I lost my son...
Uncle, you don't have to say it.
I think of you as my own.
I know, Uncle. We'll meet again. After I have the Avatar.
Let's talk about Aang.
Yeah.
Because, you know, he's the central part of the show. I like how when they introduce him at the beginning of the show, I appreciate how, like... You know, he's the Avatar and he's, you know, basically the savior of the world.
Yeah.
But he's like, he's not this like perfect Superman or anything.
Yeah.
He's not like,
it's a, like he only
a
knows
Jesus
one element.
Anything. He only has one element, but he's also, you know, he's, you know, basically just a kid.
Yeah.
And he has a lot of learning to do, not really just in terms of skill. But in terms of like personality, and such. Because
he's still like an immature kid who's like just wants to goof around and doesn't want to have discipline. And it's really cool to see him like start off as like this goofy, like kind of dumb sometimes.
Yeah.
Like, but he starts realizing how like in shambles the world is because he's all optimistic. And it's like he knows it's been like 100 years, but he's like, I'm gonna go see all my family and friends at the air temple and stuff. But yeah, like the first moment when he gets to the air temple and it's empty, but he's still like, yay, it's cool to be here. And you're like, oh, honey, like kind of moment where you're like, he's in for it. And Sokka and Katara are just kind of like, this is super awkward because he like doesn't really realize what's happened yet. But he finds like the skeleton of his original, I guess, master that was training him and stuff. And that's kind of when he has his first or one of his first Avatar state moments. The first one was when he was, I think, drowning and Zuko was trying to capture him again. But this was one of the moments, and then Katara calms him down.
I'm sorry.
It's okay. It wasn't your fault.
But you were right. And if Firebenders found this temple, that means they found the other ones too. I really am the last Airbender.
But yeah, it's interesting to see how he goes from like this chipper, like, which he never loses like his, you know, optimism and stuff throughout the show, but he very much matures.
Right.
And especially in the later seasons, he has moments where even he kind of is a jerk to people and stuff.
He pulls a Robin Hood. There'll be a couple episodes where it's like, come on, Aang, what's your problem?
But I love that they really... make you sympathize with him, and it's cool that he like voices it and talks about it too, because like the world needs the Avatar, but he needs to learn all the elements and do all this stuff that no Avatar has ever done, and he needs to like stop the Fire Lord in like a few months, and he's still just a kid, and every other Avatar had their whole life to train, and it's so much pressure, and I'm glad that it's not just easy for him.
You know, it's okay to miss Appa. What's going on with you? In the desert, all you cared about was finding Appa, and now it's like you don't care about him at all.
You saw what I did out there. I was so angry about losing Appa, I couldn't control myself. I hated feeling like that.
But now you're not letting yourself feel anything. I know sometimes it hurts more to hope, and it hurts more to care. But you have to promise me that you won't stop caring. Come on, you need a hug.
Thank you for your concern, Katara.
Yeah, because at first he doesn't want to do any of it. He doesn't want to be the Avatar.
Yeah.
And then later he kind of realizes how much everyone relies on him, and then he feels all the pressure and responsibility, and he takes it very seriously at a lot of points.
Isn't there even a point, I don't know if I'm making this up, but I feel like I remember a point where there was someone who was like a really, really masterful bender, and he was just like, you can fight him for me. You do it. You're way more powerful than I am. And I feel like there was a moment where he thought that, and they're like, yeah, but I can't learn all the elements. Like, I don't have that benefit. Like, you need to do this.
Yeah.
But he has I can't remember when it was, and it's really vague, but I remember at least one moment where he kind of had a moment like that.
It's kind of like a Frodo, like, talking to Gandalf, like, you take the ring.
Yeah.
Don't talk to me, Frodo.
I like when the character who's supposed to be the all-powerful one has a moment of, like, I don't want to do this. It's always like really compelling when the one who's supposed to be all powerful and perfect has a moment of weakness that you can actually sympathize with.
Yeah.
This goes against everything I learned from the monks. I can't just go around wiping out people I don't like.
Sure you can. You're the Avatar. If it's in the name of keeping balance, I'm pretty sure the universe will forgive you.
This isn't a joke, Sokka! None of you understands the position I'm in!
Aang, we do understand. It's just...
Just what, Katara? What?
We're trying to help.
Then when you figure out a way for me to beat the Fire Lord without taking his life, I'd love to hear it.
Aang, don't walk away from this.
Let him go. He needs time to sort it out by himself.
And that's what I like about Aang's character is, even though he's like the chosen one, you know, and has to do all this stuff, his journey to that is... it's filled with like doubts and struggles, and it's not easy for him. And I also love the concept of the Avatar, whatever element they're born with, the opposite of that is always really hard for them to learn, because elements are kind of like a mental thing. So like for water bender, like in Korra, she's a water bender, so learning fire is really hard for her. Yeah. I think that's what it is. And then for air, the opposite is earth. And it's really hard for him to learn earthbending because it's the complete opposite of what an airbender's mindset would be like. And this show just does little world building things like that. Super cool.
Yeah.
Super well. And
And also, I mean, firebending happens to be kind of easy for him, but I like how he becomes afraid to do it because
he kind of learns it early on, like pretty easily.
Yeah, and he ends up hurting Katara. And so his stumbling block is that he doesn't want to use it to hurt anyone, and he doesn't want to hurt the friend, people that is close to him.
Zhang Zhang tried to tell me that I wasn't ready. I wouldn't listen. I'm never gonna firebend again.
You'll have to eventually.
No, never again.
Even later on in the show where they're like, you need to learn it. You need to fight the fire. You need to know how to do this. He's like, nope, never using it ever again. And it's really cool. And I love that it's kind of introduced early and he just avoids doing it. And especially when like Sokka gets mad at him and stuff like that part, I'm always like, oh, it's like, I hate it hurts to
it's
watch.
Like watching family fight.
So I'm just like, dang, that's brutal, man. But that part is always kind of crazy. But it's cool, though, because that's kind of where Katara learns about her healing ability and stuff. And
so it all works out.
Yeah. You're welcome, Katara.
Yeah.
But and even stuff where Katara's kind of teaching Aang to waterbend and just moments of character development and interaction where it's like, oh, he's learning it really fast and she's getting frustrated and stuff. And Katara, yeah, like the pure, I'm the perfect one, like, yeah, steals like the how, water scroll.
I like how they the show gang. Her that she has flaws, yeah, as well.
I love that, like, about every character has moments of like, that was, don't do that. Not in like a writing sense, but in like a, you're flawed, like you need to, yeah, not in like a, that was poorly written, that was stupid that they did that, but they show they're not perfect people.
Yeah, yeah. And I mean, it's a little different with like maybe like characters like Toph or, yeah, Sokka, where they're, what's the word that I want? Oh, yeah, their flaws are kind of apparent, like,
yeah,
like from usually, the start.
Yeah, usually, but characters that tend to be a little more on the funny, sarcastic side, it's a little more obvious.
Yeah, and but it's a little less obvious for, like, you know, like for Aang, who's like a hero, you know, but especially for Katara. And it turns out that, and I guess, I don't know, we'll talk more in depth, or maybe we'll just do it now. But yeah. I mean, for now, for like for Katara, her flaw, it kind of is her strength as, yeah, well, is that she becomes like kind of like the mother of the group, and she's kind of overly protective, and that comes to a fault,
yeah,
at some times.
Don't you walk away from me while I'm talking to you!
Oh, really, Mom? Or what are you going to do, send me to my room?
I wish I could.
Well, you can't, because you're not my mom, and you're not their mom.
I never said I was.
No, but you certainly act like it. You think it's your job to boss everyone around, but it's not. You're just a regular kid like the rest of us. So stop acting like you can tell me what to do. I can do whatever I want.
I don't act that way. Sokka, do I act motherly?
Hey, I'm staying out of this one.
What do you think, Aang? Do I act like a mom?
Well, I...
Stop rubbing your eye and speak clearly when you talk.
Yes, ma'am.
She's sort of, like, full of herself sometimes, and she isn't the most humble,
yeah,
either. Like, so she has to really bring herself down to realize, okay, like, I'm not perfect for this and stuff, and seeing them learn, like, especially when, like, I think it's in season one where she steals the water scroll from that gang because she wants to learn that and stuff.
Yeah.
And it's like she would be the last person in the group to do that, but she was so jealous that Aang was learning waterbending so quickly, and she's too prideful in her skill, and you kind of start, yeah, to learn about her personality that way. But she's, and oh man, Katara has some of like the most insane moments in the show. She's not, yeah, even my favorite character, but she has some of the best moments, like the when she finds that one woman who I think was friends with her mother, and she's hiding out in the Fire Nation, yeah, and she ends up being a bloodbender.
Yeah.
And
well, she's like a waterbender, and turns out that she can also control the blood in, yeah, people's,
which
bodies.
Technically it's like all waterbenders can, but it's just not something you do.
Yeah, it's like unethical.
And she doesn't want to do it, but she's essentially forced to like get out of the situation, and it, like,
yeah,
kind of messes her up. She's like, I don't ever, like, that aspect got me, when it's like she was being bloodbended and she knows what it's like, and she was kind of like forced to do it.
Yeah.
And it kind of like messed with her.
But then, and I was a little worried that they weren't going to go back to that, but then they do when she starts to go after her mom's killer,
yeah,
or whatever.
And I
and
love
she
that
she starts to use it.
Yeah, it was almost like Aang to firebending, like bloodbending is to Katara, like when she goes after the guy who killed her father, and she's just so, this is someone she's basically been like on like wanting to kill her whole life essentially, and
yeah,
she finally finds him, and the scene where she like freezes all, she stops all the rain around,
yeah,
them, and
so
is just
cool,
like laying into him, but he's just like this confused hope, like he's too far gone, he doesn't even really remember it.
Yeah.
And it's one of those moments where it's like, yeah, he deserves to die right now, but it makes so much sense the way she handles it. And
yeah,
it's just, it's really, and it's not just like I forgive you, it's she's just is like, don't, like basically just leaves him.
I did a bad thing, I know I did. And you deserve revenge. So why don't you take my mother? That would be fair.
I always wondered what kind of person could do such a thing. But now that I see you, I think I understand. There's just nothing inside you. Nothing at all. You're pathetic and sad and empty.
Please spare me.
But as much as I hate you, I just can't do it.
Yeah.
Because it's like, you're just a hopeless, sad anything. Old man.
Yeah.
And that scene always, like, gets me. It's so powerful to me because it's so out of character, but it makes sense for her too, because mm-hmm. she's not like an angry, ruthless person, but this is something,
the death of her mother.
Yeah, this is something that's we've known about, that she's had a vendetta for. Like, this is the reason she hated the Fire Nation and Firebenders at first, was because of the death of her mother, and she finally finds the person responsible. And
yeah,
it's such an intense moment. I love it. It's such a crazy, I don't know, just bit of, that's the thing I like about this show. Every kind of little thing has some kind of conclusion, except for one part we can get into later, which is about Zuko's mom. But that aspect, I love that they even find a way to kind of have some kind of resolution within herself involving that, because she always held so much hatred to that. And it's her just kind of growing to be okay with, like, knowing that, you know, not all firebenders hashtag are bad. but it's so compelling. And that's one of my favorite parts of the show, is when you get in the Fire Nation and kind of start to see the human side of them. Even though you can still see how, like, kind of messed up they are, just because of the way, like, their government is, like, planting, you know, like, morals into their head about other people and stuff. And it's really twisted.
Brainwashing everyone.
Yeah.
It really says something about our society.
But, yeah, Katara just has a lot of great moments. And every character has a really great moment to shine. And yeah, I appreciate that.
I gotta say, one of the most intense moments in the show, and it was actually probably the first time that I felt like an emotional reaction to the show.
Yeah,
was when in season two, when Appa, the flying bison, gets taken away, and just to see, like, Aang's reaction, and he's just so, like. Like, Appa's, like, his best friend.
It's all he has left of his original life.
Yeah, that's true, too.
Which is heartbreaking. I never
thought about that.
He's the only thing from his original life he had left.
Yeah, but just to see him just, like, distraught about that.
Yeah.
Like, it's so emotional. Like, and it goes to show, like, how good the expressional animation was. And the voice actor just going, just, like, no.
Yeah, it's so good. It's so
so sad too, and he gets, like, so rageful and furious, and he's just like, I gotta find Appa, and that becomes, like, his only goal at the time. Like, nothing else matters. Like, being the Avatar or whatever, I've gotta find my best friend.
Yeah.
And even, like for the next few episodes when they're looking for him, and then there's the episode that's just focused on Appa. Even that, like, got to me emotional.
Because you're just seeing, like, how, like, abused Appa was during all this. And it's like Aang's trying to save him, and this whole time he's, like, being caged and, like, tortured. And it's just, you see everything from his point of view, and it's, like, sad and scary. Yeah.
That's when I realized that I was, like, really invested in the show. I was like, frick this stupid show for making me care about some flying buffalo.
Yeah, and the episodes, like, without him, it's cool too, because you get to see, like, how they have to basically survive without Appa. Like, you realize how important Appa is to the group. It's like, oh, they have to travel through this desert. Yeah. That whole sequence is cool too, when they're having to survive in the desert and get back, and it kind of just, I love that it's a writing technique in, like, even video games or, like, movies or shows that I love, is when there's something that's just there from the start and it's just natural. Like, they always have Appa. That's how they get around. Or in a game where it's like, oh, you have a mechanic from the start and you're just used to that. And then at some point it's like, they take it away from you. And it's like, what do I do without this? Like, I'm trying to think of a video game example, but it's like, example, like Shadow of the Colossus.
Agra?
Yeah, it's not really a good example because you're not exploring the world without him, because you're right at the boss, but it's like the thought of, oh, I don't have this companion I've had the whole time, and you can still whistle for him, but he won't come. And so in, like, this scene, it's like, we're just used to them having Appa. That's how they get around. How are they going to do things without him. And I love seeing how they have to deal with that. And when they finally are reunited, it's just like so like heartwarming and nice. Yeah. And it feels
all sorts of happy feelings.
It gets me every time. And when he flies from around the corner and they see him and it's like, Abba!
Yeah.
Oh man, it's so good.
Yeah. So yeah, it was definitely around that time where I was like, yeah, I think I'm really loving this show.
Nice.
All of the characters just have like something to them. Like even Sokka,
yeah,
who at first is just
kind of... He's just kind of like the comic relief, but he still gets a lot of really cool moments and you learn a lot of like emotional things about him too.
He goes through a lot and you kind of don't even realize.
That's what I like.
His girlfriend turns into the moon.
Yeah. Like he has horrible like luck with people he loves, like his relationships with girls and stuff. And when you, I think the point where you really start to be like, oh, like learning a lot about him as a character, it's cool because when they meet his dad, finally they find him and it's been a long time since they've seen him and stuff. And you realize he's always looked up to his dad. He like idolizes his dad and his dad's also kind of goofy and funny. And you realize
that was really funny.
Yeah. It's kind of cool. Cause it's like, oh, he just wants to be like his dad. That's why he's goofy. But when he has serious moments, he really, you know, he's not always just like comic relief. And he does there is a point in the show where he's kind of consistently like, almost the leader. He's kind of becomes like an authority in the group where he's like, we need to stay on track and focused. And
episode where in season one where I was like, how is like Sokka the only like logical, reasonable character? And it was the one with the what's his name character, the Lost Boys Robin Hood.
Oh yeah,
what's his name again?
Jet. Yeah, because he's the only one who how scummy they are.
Yeah, the episode where they meet him, like, Aang is just like, oh, whatever, and Katara's fallen in love with Jet.
Yeah.
And Sokka's just like,
they're
no.
going to kill a whole village of people.
It's honestly kind of a little frustrating to me. Is that kind of aspect where, like, the person sees the truth and the other people just aren't believing them.
Yeah, I think the reason it's frustrating to me, in like kind of a good way, is because you feel Sokka's frustration because I see it as like it's not really obvious to everyone that they would be bad because Sokka just kind of happened to overhear them talking.
Yeah.
So it's not like they're obviously scummy bad people. They're just really good at like manipulating the others. But Sokka was the only one who actually like audibly heard them talking about these horrible things. And it's done in a way where it's believable because obviously Sokka's just kind of like jealous of how cool Jet is at first. So they think he's just trying to play him down.
That kind of clouds the character's judgment. Yeah.
If Jet was obviously like rude and evil in front of everyone and they were still like that, I'd be like, this is kind of bad writing. But they do it in a way that it would make sense, even if it still is a little really like black and white to the point to where they're all like, you suck, Sokka. We hate you.
It also is kind of heartbreaking when Katara does like realize the truth.
Yeah.
Sokka, you fool! We could have freed this valley. Who would be free? Everyone would be dead. You traitor! No, Jet. You became the traitor when you stopped protecting innocent people. Katara, please, help me.
Goodbye, Jet.
Yip, yip.
She's like, oh, I...
She just leaves him frozen against the tree.
Yeah, and honestly, I didn't expect to see him again in the show.
Yeah.
I was surprised when they brought him back.
I remember he asked me if he died or whatever, and I was just like,
I know a lot of people have like speculated about that. I know that he died, like when he comes back later in the show.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, people have always just like, yeah, but did he? I'm like, yes, he died. That's the one thing about this show, is that they're kind of afraid of like death.
Yeah.
They're afraid of talking about death because it's a kid's
show.
Yeah,
it's like a Nickelodeon thing.
So they
kind of
go around it.
It was like in Korra where pilots would be in airplanes and like they would explode, but it's like you have to show the person falling out with a parachute.
Yeah.
It's one of those. Like they can't kill people on a kid's show for Nickelodeon. So.
But even, in the third season, I noticed that they were getting a lot more brave. They were actually saying like, kill them.
Yeah, they actually used the words dead and kill.
I was like, what?
Yeah.
Shame on this show. So that's just interesting. I mean, it's understandable.
I think they work around it really well without it. It feels like they use that obstacle to come up with creative solutions or writing.
You know what they're insinuating.
Yeah. It's like, you could tell they probably wanted to have some people die at some points, but they use that obstacle to be like, how can we work around this and make it still like interesting? And that's what I really appreciate about this show is they never just like, well, we can't kill anyone. So just, I don't know, have him say, I'm okay. And then he leaves. It's like, they come up with a way to make the narrative still like makes sense, and it doesn't feel like they were it. Sometimes you could be like, it feels like they're limited, but the way it was still executed is still fine.
Yeah.
And which is what I like about it. Cause like in Korra, it just doesn't make sense. Sometimes I'm like, okay, like
I haven't watched that, but
it's good. If you liked this show, I still think it's totally worth watching, but it's not near as good in my opinion.
Right. Yeah. But it also does help that like, most of the characters have like these, you know, these bending abilities. They don't have like swords and guns that like, you know, obviously if no one dies from that, that's obviously chickening out.
Yes.
But it's like you have like water bending, like, yeah, just push them out with water or push them away with
air. They
fall
off a cliff. It's like, you can assume they probably died, but they're not going to point
it
out.
Hit them with a rock. They probably died. Yeah. But, you know.
Just close them up. Trap them and leave, and there's like stuff with Sokka when he gets his sword later on and stuff. And,
yeah,
but I mean, even then, they still make it like cool. It's still cool. Like when there's
it's
like
not
sword
too
fights.
Distracting. But yeah, so going back to Sokka, he's a great character, and I appreciate how they show that he's a whole lot more than just either the comic relief or just like the very obtuse leader or whatever.
It's like he's funny and goofy, but he's not dumb. Like he's still very smart and he can be a
and
good leader.
I like how they let that, they help that be obvious. One of my favorite episodes was when he's learning to sword fight with the sword master. I really like that.
Yeah, he gets his own like special sword from him, and he has to earn like his favor. I love that episode, and I'm realizing that's why I like samurai movies. Just I love stuff like that where it's like working with the master and earning his favor, and like I think stuff like that's always really cool. And I love that little arc with him like getting his sword and having the train, and because that's cool because. That's something when I remember watching this show and I was like, it must suck to be Sokka, to be surrounded by all these benders and to just have a boomerang. And they touch on that. Like, he's frustrated. He's like, you guys all have these cool powers and what am I doing?
Boo-hoo. Poor heroes.
What's your problem? You haven't even touched your smoke sea slug.
It's just all you guys can do this awesome bending stuff, like putting out forest fires and flying around and making other stuff fly around. I can't fly around, okay? I can't do anything.
That's not true. No one can read a map like you.
I can't read at all.
Yeah, and who keeps us laughing with sarcastic comments all the time?
Look, I appreciate the effort, but the fact is, each of you is so amazing and so special, and I'm not. I'm just the guy in the group who's regular.
I'm sorry you're feeling so down, but I hope you know none of us see you that way.
Yeah.
Like, I'm not, like, I love that they
throw
touch
on a boomerang.
That. And so he's like, I need something of my own. And so he goes to do this, like, really intense sword training. And I think it's cool that they kind of gave him something and that they touched
and
on that.
And they
the
also
show
that, like, at the same time, he still was a very crucial part of the team.
Yeah, he never
like
feels
when he's
unnecessary.
Gone, they're just like, well, what do we do now?
Yeah, I love that. Every character feels important. And even when, like, Toph shows up, I go back
to
earlier.
I do want to talk about Toph.
Yeah, and I love Toph. And every time I go back to watch the show, I just, like, I can't wait for Toph to show up. Like, whenever I watch season one, I'm like, I miss Toph.
Yeah, it's like when the group is solidified, it's a little difficult to watch earlier episodes because
you're so
the
used
whole
to the
group
dynamic
is not there. Take a shot every time we say dynamic. don't, you'll die.
I love how Toph at first they're so used to how the three of them work together, and like we have this new person and they're getting frustrated with her, and it's like a new roommate moves in and they're annoying, but they have to. I love that. Like that's what really impresses me about this show, and not even just for a kids show. Like, this is something like adult shows fail to do sometimes is this new character comes on and it's not just, oh, we're all friends now. It's like they have to get used to each other. They don't really know her that well. And they frustrate each other. And I love the dynamic of them. Dynamic having to get used to each other's company.
Yes.
And it changes how they all interact with each other in a way, having a new person there.
Yeah. I guess we're talking about Toph right now.
Yeah.
I wanted to talk about Sokka's relationship with what's her name, the fighting girl, whatever.
Oh,
I just thought it was cute, you know.
Yeah, Suki.
Suki, yeah.
Yeah, I'm really glad they end up together.
Yeah, I was kind of
the way she.
I didn't think
back.
That it was going to work, but they made it work. So
yeah, it's really, and it feels like natural. Like she kind of shows them. She shows up, but then they have to separate again, and they it's really cool the way that they end up continually connecting.
Yeah, and with Toph. She is such a different character because before Toph, all the characters are just kind of like, oh, quirky, fun. And then Toph shows up and she's like the short,
mean.
She's short, the short little mean blind girl.
Yeah, it's such a different kind
she's
of character.
Kind of a little bully.
Yeah, she's like kind of mean and rude to them. And like, she'll like, oh my gosh, I'm trying to remember the line, but. She calls Katara like something and it makes me laugh every time. I need to.
She calls Aang Twinkle Toes.
Yeah. God, there's like, it's one moment when she's in the group pretty fresh and her and Katara aren't getting along really well. And she keeps calling her like, God, what does she keep calling her? I can't remember, but it's.
Ever since you joined us, you've been nothing but selfish and unhelpful.
What? Look here, Sugar Queen. I gave up everything I had so that I could teach Aang earthbending. So don't you talk to me about being selfish.
Sugar Queen?
I don't know. I can't remember, but just the way she kind of insults people. But
she has, she's
like
she's
not
got
trying
some
to be
great
like
comebacks.
Yeah, and it's not like she's trying to just be like mean, but you can tell she's just like defensive and sarcastic.
Yeah, and it's the way that she is, and I love that about her because like she comes from this family that's super protective of her,
yeah,
and doesn't let her go outside or anything. And here she has the second life as like this wrestling earthbender.
Yeah, she's out like beating like grown men in earthbending tournaments because she's
it's
like the
so
best.
Hilarious.
She's the most powerful earthbender in the world, essentially.
Yeah.
Which she invents steel metal bending.
Which is crazy.
That's such a cool moment when she breaks out of that prison when the guys come to capture her to bring her home because her parents are psychos and they hire these freaks to
killers.
Capture her and bring her back home. That's a common theme I've noticed with all the main characters, and I think why they work so well together is all of them have either lost family or have like a broken family. Like Aang lost everyone he knows. Katara and Sokka lost their mother and their father is off at war and they hardly see him. And then
Toph just doesn't want to be around her parents.
Yeah. Cause her parents are controlling and like rich, like snobs and don't want her doing anything. And it's great. I love the moment when she just
Zulu's
leaves.
Father is just a,
Zuko, like all.
Oh, I said Zulu.
Oh, Zulu. Sorry, but yes,
I mean Zuko.
But even Zuko, like his family is just all kinds of messed up. Like his sister, his mother is gone. His father, like, beat the crap out of him. And he joins that group too. So it's just all these main characters. Just
also,
come
you
from
got
broken
you got
families.
One person from every bending. And you even got one just normal person.
Yeah, because they're intentionally, and it's cool.
And a monkey
they're like,
and a flying bison.
Yeah, because it's cool because they're intentionally like, that's such a good way of adding on new characters because he has learned all the elements. So we have to find an earthbender.
And it's also
we have to find a firebender.
It's also just a simple way of like showing that like, no matter what background you are, no matter what like nation you're from, you can still work together as a team.
Exactly. And it also shows, you know, going back to the theme of all of them having broken families and stuff, like they're all from different backgrounds and nations, but they have this thing in common.
Yeah.
And they all are fighting for the same goal. Even Zuko eventually is like, yeah, I'm going to help you kill my dad. And it's just so cool. And I love when they,
no, it's not.
I love when they realize, yeah, Zuko is going to have to be my firebending teacher.
Yeah.
And The mentality aspect of bending is really cool too, because Zuko is suddenly, he's trying to be like helpful and he's not always angry and wrathful, and then suddenly he can't bend anymore. And yeah, that whole thing, it's not like my favorite aspect of the show, that element, but I like it as a, oh, it, like your mentality is connected to your bending, and mm-hmm. they have to, and but I love the, it is, it does sort of feel like filler when it's like, oh, he can't bend, he has to learn to bend again, okay, now he's just like, I feel like without that episode it wouldn't be that big of a deal. Yeah, but I still really like it because it shows that he has to, he is really changing as a person, and he kind of has to rework like how he bends and stuff, and it's just a clever little way to show his character changing, and they have to go and find the dragons, and that's a cool little like side plot, I thought, when they go to that one city and yeah. stuff. But
and they also find out that Uncle Iroh didn't end up killing off all the dragons.
Yeah, because there's like two of them there, and they,
he's like, no, he's just a genuinely good person. And, yeah. yeah. Didn't want anyone to know.
Exactly. And lightning bending. That's what, another thing I love is all the elements kind of have this secondary thing. I'm not sure what it would be for air bending, but with water, you know, there's blood bending. With earth, yeah. there's now metal bending because of Toph. And then with fire, there's lightning.
Yeah.
So it's in the lightning bending thing is so cool. And I love how it's relevant. He doesn't just learn to do that, and then he uses it once and it's cool. It really comes into play, like Iroh teaching him how to redirect lightning and all this stuff. And
yeah. Yeah. It is super smart. You know?
Yeah. The way they explain
it's
it.
It's not just like, oh, I know how to do it. It's like, no, lightning is like a very hard thing to control.
Yeah. And he's like, and if you don't redirect it properly, it will kill you. And it's so intense. And
sorry to say the K word, but it will kill you.
I love just, again, going back to the world building, I'm going to say that so much, but when Iroh's explaining how it's similar to water bending, like the movements, he's like, I studied water bending, and
yeah.
like how you get to just learn a lot, and all the all the elements are like the movements that benders use for each element are based off real like kung fu fighting techniques in real life. I don't know the names, but it's like air bending is like this technique, and
yeah,
it's all animated like perfectly. Like I know people who have taught, and they're like, I'm really impressed with how on point the animation for those like techniques are, and it's so cool. And then yeah, he's like trying to learn lightning, and he's like, okay, shoot lightning at me. And I was like, no, you're crazy, I'm not gonna do that. And it's like kind of a funny moment, but then they show Zuko and it's storming out and he's up on the hill. That's a really like powerful scene for me, when he's just like, you've always thrown everything you got at me, and he's like, well, I'm here now. He's like freaking out on this hill, and he's just crying, and he's like yeah. wanting lightning to strike him. And obviously it's like, it really is like more metaphorical for him just talking about his life in general, but it's just I love that moment, because that's kind of when you start to realize like, yeah, he's going through like a drastic change right now. And
yeah,
I love that moment.
You've always thrown everything you could at me. Well, I can take it, and now I can give it back. Come on, strike me. You've never held back before.
And that's great. How the episode ends too, just him like crying on a hill. I'm just like, jeez.
And then In the Air Tonight by Phil Collins plays in the background.
Yeah. But I'll touch on this real quick too. We can go on to another character or something, but the lightning redirection technique. I never thought about this, but I saw a Twitter post about it and I was like, oh geez, and that's true. I didn't think about this. When he confronts his father and the Fire Lord just shoots lightning at him, and he redirects it back at him successfully. Yeah. And I never thought about this, but lightning will like kill you. It killed Aang basically, and Katara had to basically bring him back to life with that water that she was going to use to heal Zuko's scar, but it was it was good that she saved it. But, but yeah, his father essentially just attempted to kill him, and he redirects it. And I never really thought about how his dad doesn't know that lightning redirection is a technique. That's like an Iroh thing. Like he, the Fire Lord, he didn't know that that was possible. Yeah. So he was fully intending to murder his son when he did
Yeah, I figured that.
Yeah, I never really thought about it because I was like, oh, maybe like, you know. But when you think about how lethal lightning is in the show and how it can instantly kill people, like
or in real
I never
life.
Really thought about how, oh, like, yeah, his dad was definitely
well,
just
even
like,
if
trying
I didn't, I wasn't sure if the Fire Lord knew about redirecting or not. Either way, he didn't know that Zuko knew how to do
that. Yeah, exactly.
So I kind of knew, it was like, oh, dang, he just tried to kill his own son.
Yeah. So it's something I just never thought about because I was like, oh, yeah. And it's just like a cool subtlety with how messed up the Fire Lord is. And it's a good way to bring back redirecting lightning. It's not just a thing that's there for a couple episodes. Reincorporation is a big thing in this show. And I love when things come back and are relevant. And yeah, it's just really cool.
Yeah. And speaking of the Fire Lord, not even really speaking about the Fire Lord, because there's not really a whole lot to say about the Fire Lord because he's kind of just...
He really is this like evil
guy.
He's
kind of like a one-dimensional villain. Yeah. You know? I mean, you learn a little bit more about him in the flashback
episode.
His
character is more... He is just the villain, and you know, like, all of this bad stuff is happening because of him. And you do learn about how, like, the Fire Lord previous to him, how he kind of rose up to be how he is, and you don't ever sympathize with him. He is just evil, evil man, did evil things. But I do, he is mainly there as a way to enhance Zuko's character. Kind of like how we talked about one of the characters in season 3 of Robin Hood, like kind of shows up and they're there to boost other characters, not necessarily to be like a developed character themselves.
Uh-huh.
That's kind of how I see the Fire Lord because he's such a big part of Zuko's character and
he's such a good guy.
Yeah. But they really do make him like someone you hate.
Yeah, like, for sure. It's easy to hate him.
Yeah. But it's not like a villain where it's like, I can see your point. Like, he really is just like
he's
evil.
Not like
he
Thanos just, or anything.
Yeah, he really is just like, I want power and I'm evil.
He's basically like a Hitler, you know?
Yeah.
He's like, I want the whole world to be the Fire Nation.
Yeah. But you do, I do appreciate that you know a lot about, you know, Azula and Zuko, and they talk about him, and you learn a lot about just how you learn a lot of the details of how horrible he is and why you should hate him. It's not the show isn't like here he is, he's bad, we'll never do anything to show why he's bad. But
yeah,
I like that they develop his evilness in a way.
Just how evil.
So he is just like evil. There's never a moment where it's like, oh, he could be a good guy, but I'm glad they at least they give you a really valid reason to want him dead.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. I don't like it when movies or shows, like, I like it when certain characters that are like evil at first are given more of a human aspect.
Yeah.
Like with Zuko, and we talked about Guy of Gisborne in the last episode.
Yeah.
But like, I don't like it when like the ultimate evil of the movie or show is like turned to be like a good guy or something.
For like
or not
no
even
reason.
A good guy, but just like humanized or whatever.
Yeah.
As long as it's, I mean, if it's done interestingly,
if it's
enough,
done well in a way that doesn't feel like weird, like you're trying to humanize him, but why would you try to humanize someone? That's kind of like where it is. It's like, if they tried to humanize the Fire Lord, I would be like, why are you doing this?
Mostly,
like he's clearly like awful.
And mostly because I think it's important for people to realize that there is like just evil out in the world.
Yeah.
And so I think that's important to like make that distinction.
Because he really is just kind of like a Hitler, you know, like he's like my every other element is weak and we like imprison other people and torture them and do all this bad stuff. Like there's no reason for him to be like sympathetic. The only time you ever get some kind of humanity with him is where it's like, it's the flashback episode where, it's the Avatar before
Avatar. What's his name?
What's his name? Avatar Roku.
Avatar Roku.
I should know this. It's the firebending Avatar, and I think he kind of grew up with Fire Lord.
Yeah, he did.
That whole episode I think is really cool, and not even that is like, oh, Fire Lord was a good guy. It's like, no, he basically killed the Avatar and like left him on the island.
I mean, he started out as a good guy, but he obviously had some very warped ideology.
Yeah,
and that's what.
But it was cool to see. It's like, yeah, he was like friends, and you could see how at one point he could have, you know, been likable, but it shows his demise.
And this wasn't even the current Fire Lord. It was the father.
Yeah, that's of it. The current Fire that's Lord. That's it, yeah. Right? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and that's kind of what started the whole war and all that. And it's very, very tragic. The whole story.
Was yeah, like the episode's really cool.
The like the volcano erupting and then blah blah blah.
Yeah, and him just being left there to die, and it's really brutal. Yeah, that I remember at one point I was like, man, almost like a show about all of that would be kind of cool. But if anything, I actually don't think they should do a show about that because we know everything already. But I'm like,
yeah, everything there is.
But it was interesting enough that I was like, even like a little side spinoff miniseries of the life of that avatar would be kind of interesting. But
yeah,
maybe. It was well done enough that I almost wanted more, but it was enough.
Yeah, and I also liked how they were tying that with Zuko's relationship with Aang.
Yeah,
because it was Iroh that wanted him to read all that history.
Yeah,
and like make that distinction. But I wanted to talk about who I think is a far more interesting villainous character than the Fire Lord.
Yeah.
Princess Azulu.
Yeah.
Azula.
Azuzu.
I'm getting all the names mixed up. Plus, I only watched the show once, so
yeah, it's okay.
Get off my
back. I couldn't remember.
Get off my back. Ow.
Oh my gosh. I couldn't remember some of the characters' names. It's okay.
Yeah.
Pretty sure it's like Ozai. That's the Fire Lord. Fire Lord Ozai. I don't know. Ruko?
He's just fine.
That's Zuko. I don't know. Whatever.
Avatar Ruko?
No. Roku.
Roku.
Yeah, because like the TV thing, Roku. That's it. Yeah. See, you remembered that, and it's my favorite show, and I couldn't even remember.
Well, only because you...
I got it close.
Yeah. But Azula is such an interesting character. At first, you think that she's just going to be...
She's like the Joker. Like, I'm insane. Woo!
Well, not even... Well, you don't even realize that at first, because at first, she's just this like really strict... Like,
yeah,
just a female bad guy.
Yeah.
And just kind of a,
you just think
kind
she's
of a B word. You
kind
of
are. I remember when I was originally watching it, even as a kid, I was like, kind of like thinking about stuff like this, like critically, but I was like, oh, so she just going to, cause I was like, oh, Zuko's good now. So they need a new Zuko to like when I, so I was kind of worried it was just going to be like that simple. Like yeah. She was, but she is, which she does do what Zuko was doing because the Fire Lord is like, well, Zuko isn't doing that anymore. So it makes sense. And they established her and stuff. It's not just like,
but at the same time, when they introduce her, Zuko's still kind of going through his whole character arc. And she's kind of there to be that like,
yeah, she's introduced,
devil on his shoulder. Sort
yeah.
Of like.
She's introduced at the perfect moment. I think.
Princess. I'm afraid the tides will not allow us to bring the ship into port before nightfall.
I'm sorry, Captain, but I do not know much about the tides. Can you explain something to me?
Of course, Your Highness.
Do the tides command this ship?
I'm afraid I don't understand.
You said the tides would not allow us to bring the ship in. Do the tides command this ship?
No, Princess.
And if I were to have you thrown overboard? Would the tides think twice about smashing you against the rocky shore?
No, Princess.
Well then, maybe you should worry less about the tides, who've already made up their mind about killing you, and worry more about me, who's still mulling it over.
I'll pull us in.
Yeah, and I love how, like, she obviously has this, like, this power dynamic about her. Like, she's like a leader, and she like Zuko wants to be like her dad.
Yeah,
but she's just willing to go to much greater lengths than Zuko, and she's just pure evil. Even when you see her as a kid,
yeah,
she's just evil.
She's very much her father, and Zuko is very much like her mother.
Yeah,
his mother. Yeah. Their mother. God.
Yeah. But it's so interesting to see all that just like kind of crumble away near like in season three.
Yeah.
Because you got Ty Lee and the other girl.
May.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. They're like her like henchmen or whatever, hench girls. at first. And
I like how they kind of show how manipulative Azul is, because especially when she's trying to get Ty Lee to join her, and Ty Lee is like, I'm good here at the circus, I'm fine. And then she like does something to basically just scare and intimidate her into joining. And when she went to her show.
Yeah.
And she, you could tell Ty Lee was like, I don't want her here. And they're like, oh, take the net away and light it on fire. And she's like, okay, fine, I'll join you. And just shows it's not like they like Azula that much, but they were manipulated into joining her. And that's a really good way to establish Azula.
Yeah. And then that all falls apart in the episode where May helps. Well, May and Ty Lee.
The prison escape.
Yeah, the prison escape one. And that's just, that was just like, like when Ty Lee just like paralyzes Azula, just beats her down. That's like the catalyst. And like from then on, you just start to see Azula just go crazy.
Yeah, because she starts realizing like, oh, I'm on my own. And like the people I thought were my friends, even though I like emotionally abused them, are against me now. And she's just like going insane.
And she starts mistrusting everyone.
Yeah.
She's firing everyone all the way to the point that she's the only one in the palace.
Azula, we heard what happened. Why have you banished all your servants, all your Ty Lee agents, and the Imperial Firebenders?
None of them could be trusted. Sooner or later, they all would have betrayed me. Just like May and Ty Lee did.
Azula, we are concerned for you and your well-being.
My father asked you to come here and talk to me, didn't he? He thinks I can't handle the responsibility of being Fire Lord. But I will be the greatest leader in Fire Nation history.
Oh my god, she's in, oh man, the scene where she really loses it and she just like cuts her hair, and her and Zuko's Agony Kai is like one of the coolest fights in the whole show.
Oh yeah.
It's insane, and her blue fire is like really just crazy.
I'm sorry it has to end this way, brother.
No, you're not.
Blue fire is like way more hot than normal fire in real life, so it just shows how like powerful and crazy she is. And it's cool that it's like kind of unique to her.
Yeah.
And then she's just like shooting lightning left and right, like she's so reckless. But
yeah,
the scene where they basically get her down and they lock her to the thing on the, they like kind of handcuff her and trap her to the grate or whatever on the floor, and she's just like freaking out and like breathing fire and like contorting on the ground and crying. I was like, that part's like genuinely unsettling when she's just losing her mind and crying and breathing fire and screaming on the floor. I'm like, this is like creepy. It like creeped me out when I watched it as a kid. I was like, whoa.
When she's just lost control of everything, she's just, she just goes crazy.
Just totally lost her mind. And yeah, that scene always sticks out in my mind, like when I think about it.
It's just so interesting. And
it's cool because you think she's this like really, she comes across as this really like disciplined, like,
really smart,
determined, smart, but you realize how full of herself she, like, she thinks she can control everything. And when she realizes she can't, that's, you realize how insecure and like, you know, messed up she is in her head and stuff. And I love that even her just having to be another villain, they develop her in a way where it's like she's not just the same villain throughout. Like, she goes from like, you know, a threat who just shows up every once in a while to, you see how she just falls into like this craziness, you know. A lot of shows just have the bad guy, like they just stay like the same amount of bad. They don't really develop in any way, and not develop like, oh, we get to learn about how traumatized and sad they are. It's like, no, I mean, develop their motivation for why they're doing what they're doing, you know. And it makes them even worse in a way. And even like the episode where there's sort of like the one episode that humanizes her a bit, when the beach episode and stuff. But you see how like awkward she is at socializing with people. It's so funny.
It's like, yes, we can get together and then we'll take over the world. Like, wait, whoa, what?
Yeah. She's trying to flirt and she's like, yeah, you and me can hang out and then we will dominate the planet and stuff. And
it's
super funny.
Yeah, but I actually really, like, the episode was a bit, is bit off-putting at first.
It was weird. You could tell it's kind of fan service-y, like they're all in swimsuits.
A little bit, but
it's
yeah.
still such a good development, especially it's still such a good development episode, especially when they're all on the beach around the fire at night.
Yeah.
That's such a good scene.
Yeah, see, that's the thing that like differentiates it from most like filler fan service-y episodes is that there is still like something to it.
Yeah, you still take something away from the episode where it's like that wasn't pointless, you know. Yeah. You're like, okay, I learned something about these people.
Yeah. And it still is interesting to like put those characters in that setting.
Yeah,
of like
so
some sort of like high school drama.
Yeah,
or whatever.
It's one of those moments of world building where it's like, oh cool, so this is what like Fire Nation teenagers do.
You
learn a little something about a lot. You learn a lot about Fire Nation culture.
Yeah,
it's really cool.
It's like a Mean Girls meets Avatar.
Like the village with the lady in the water, the that episode is really like weird and interesting. And yeah,
although I always thought like, Aang, how do you not realize that that's Katara?
Yeah. Yeah,
she's like 10 feet away from you.
For real.
Wait, Katara?
Yeah.
But yeah, I was watching this YouTuber that I watch. It's called Cosmodor. He does a lot of videos on like animated shows and movies, and he had a whole episode dedicated to his least favorite episodes of Avatar, and that was really that kind of helped me like refresh my memories of the show.
Totally.
But yeah, with like the beach episode, he's like, they knew what they were doing with that.
with
the beach scene.
It's like surprisingly it's surprisingly kind of risque.
Yeah.
Like
Ty Lee is like the biggest
she was like waifu bait on that episode. But I mean, they make fun of that because all the guys are like obsessed with her and no one's paying attention to Mei or Azula.
Yeah.
It's kind of funny.
Yeah.
They totally know what they're doing, and that's why it's funny.
It's like, yeah, I probably would have fallen victim to that if I were the right age.
Yeah.
Watching that show.
And Mei and Zuko's relationship is so freaking funny, the way they talk.
It's so like emo dating relationship.
They're super making fun of like emo types.
Yeah.
And it's like, I don't hate you. I don't hate you too. It's like so dumb.
I also love the way that they portray like teen relationships, even with Zuko and I keep forgetting her name.
Ty Lee?
No.
I
mean Sokka. I said Zuko. What's wrong with me?
Oh, Suki. Sokka and Suki.
Really?
Is it
I never even realized.
I don't think I ever really.
Funny.
Yeah, Suki. Yeah, I don't think I ever really connected that actually.
But just like the way that they portray, just like when they're like sitting down and just kind of like leaning next to each other.
Yeah.
I'm like, that has such like high school relationship energy.
Yeah.
Right.
That's what's so good about this show is they do not skip out on like subtleties and making things believable just in body language or expressions or how people.
Just
you
like,
know,
yeah,
handle.
We're dating. We lean on each other now. Yeah. We can't now. We got to stand 6 feet apart.
Yeah. it's good.
Yeah.
Everything is great.
Yeah. So, I mean, we've been talking about it for a while.
Yeah.
So, like, closing statements.
Let's talk. I guess the last thing we can talk about is, like, how did you feel about the finale of the show?
Finale? I remember really thinking that I genuinely really wanted Aang to kill the Fire Lord.
Yeah, when I watched it, I knew it would happen.
Like,
so I was,
I understand.
Yeah.
Like, I don't really 100% feel like it was a cop out that he didn't end up doing it because it was kind of almost a worse.
The punishment he gets is like. Worse, almost
worse than
he can never bend again, and he's just locked away for life.
Yeah, and he like, has no power,
loses his
anymore.
Power, and he has to live and see his son be Fire Lord. And
yeah,
in a way, that's why I like. I mentioned this earlier. How maybe in a more mature like if it wasn't Nickelodeon, maybe they would have had him die or something. But yeah, it's like the Batman aspect where he just doesn't want to kill people. And I think they pull that because that is like a tropey thing where the hero doesn't want to kill people. But
I think they make it interesting for Aang because like he's constantly being influenced to kill the Fire Lord.
Everyone is saying
even like the past avatars that he's communicating with, they're like, yes, kill him.
He's literally everyone, like all of his friends. Past avatars, it just shows how well Aang knows himself and how he knows,
and it is a real conflict for him too. Yeah,
and I love that aspect where there's even the episode where he's just like, I'm gonna have to kill him, like that's how the episode ends. He's like, I'm gonna have to kill the Fire Lord, like I can't not do that. And then he learns that technique. He goes to the spirit world and learns the technique of how to take away bending, and that comes back for that, and it's just great. And you can totally, like, I remember watching it and it's like the fight itself is a super cool, by the way.
Yeah.
But the way when he finally, you know, locks them all up and he goes up to him and he's like about to like snap his neck and then he just takes his bending away, and it's so it's so cool. Like they still made it really cool.
Yeah, in the end it still was satisfying. I just remember having that like strong feeling.
Yeah, it's like
like, no, I'm not gonna kill you. I'm gonna take away your powers. I'm all right.
And okay. I think it's a pretty good message for, you know, like a kid's show, you know, not to not just be like, which I mean, for evil dictator who killed tons of people and whatever, but for a, you know, a show like this, I think it fit the message of what the show is kind of trying to communicate.
Which I think is good,
because it's not like they let him just be a citizen. It's like, okay, you can't bend, so just be good. It's like, no, you're locked away for your life.
Be a good guy. Okay, I will.
Yeah, it's like, no, we're taking away your powers and your power. Government power, and you're going to be locked away and miserable for the rest of your life, and you don't deserve.
We're not going to kill you, but you're going to want to kill yourself.
It's not like everyone forgives him. It's like they still show, it's like, yeah, he was evil and he is locked away and going to be miserable forever. Like,
he doesn't come back for Legend of Korra, does he?
No.
Okay, good. Because that was one thing that I was afraid of. Was like, oh, well, is
I'm
not
pretty sure
he would
be dead by that point.
Like, okay, I couldn't. Gone. I don't really know exactly how far ahead.
Korra honestly rarely incorporates characters from Airbender. It's like a lot of their children. Like the head of the police is Toph's daughter, who is like a lot older. Katara's the only one who's like alive in that show at first, and she's really old. But everyone else is dead. But you get to see some flashbacks of them being older, which is really cool. Like, you get to see Aang older with a beard and stuff. But a lot of the characters in that show are, like, their children.
Gotcha.
Which is cool. There is a lot about Korra that I like. But it's just each season kind of wraps up everything. And then the next season is a whole new thing. There's not, like...
they weren't sure if there was going to be another season.
Kinda, yeah. Mm. And a lot of it just... the characters aren't as... they're still good characters, but they're just... you can't top the characters in Last Airbender. It's really... and they're good, but...
especially when you're comparing, like, one season to, like, three seasons of them just growing together.
Yeah, but for a sequel show with all new characters, just being in this more developed world where like cars are starting to become a thing and stuff, it's cool, and it's really well animated. It's like gorgeous, and Korra is a cool character, and it's worth watching if you really loved Last Airbender, but it's nowhere near as good. But I still like it. There's a lot of cool, it still does world building stuff really well and whatnot, but it's just, you can tell that it's just disappointing because there's like a really cool villain and then they kind of like just wrap up that whole thing in season one, and then season two is a different thing, and it's hard to like get connected to the show because they keep wrapping things up after each season, and it's still only a couple seasons like the original show,
kind of like American Horror Story.
But it's not like one long journey that's like has a really epic, awesome, satisfying conclusion. It's just like each season is kind of its own thing, sort of, but it's still really good.
Maybe one of these days I'll check it out. I'm actually more just like, I kind of just want to rewatch Avatar again.
It's one of the most rewatchable shows.
The only thing holding me back is kind of like what we mentioned earlier. Is like
it's harder to watch the first season, like without all the characters we like and going back to things not being as developed. But
yeah,
it's really exciting to see it all play out again and to notice some things maybe you didn't notice the first time. It's like true. Every time I watch it, it's honestly still really fun to see them like go through all that.
But also, I'd want to get like my own copy because
get the series on Blu-ray.
I used another source when I when I watched it this time. I actually recently I realized it was still on my computer and I had to, that's taking up a lot of space there.
I know we just kind of fanboyed over like the story and characters and stuff, but just real quick, I don't want to take up too much more time because this is a long one, but I also just want to point out, I think the art direction in the show is fantastic and the animation itself, normal like dialogue walking around is like nothing mind blowing, but the action and combat animation is great and exciting and it's just really well done. And the music is super good too. Like the credits song is really,
without a doubt, I've probably already used it in editing this episode.
Good. But it's, the music in the show is great. I just think as a whole package, I just love everything about it. And some of the most memorable, likable characters in any show I've watched, really satisfying one, like my favorite ending to a show. It just, nothing about it's disappointing to me. And I think that's why it's still my favorite show, because every time I watch it, I still like feel emotional and I still get excited to see things happen again, even though I've seen it like 5 times.
Yeah.
And yeah, it's just great. And if you want to wrap up your thoughts too, I know I talked a lot this episode too. But I want you to speak a little more while you can.
Yeah, I just overall, I really enjoyed it. Like you can tell already by all my statements and my desire to just watch it again. There aren't many shows that I'm just like, I really want to watch that again.
Mm-hmm.
So that says a lot, especially since like any other kid show. No.
Yeah.
I don't think so. But this definitely has a lot of mature qualities about it that a person at my age can appreciate, even after not growing up with it. That's just a testament to how good it is. I mean, granted, like I said, there are some flaws to it or things that I don't necessarily resonate with me, especially during the first season. But the good overall outweighs the bad, and it's so enjoyable. The characters are so likable. There are no like main characters that I ever got tired of. There are some, main characters that I thought when they were first introduced, I'm like, I don't know if I'm gonna like this person.
Yeah,
and then I did end up doing, even with like
such, which could show like that's maybe it's trying to get you to feel what the other characters are feeling at the time.
Yeah.
It's true. I don't know about this guy.
I don't know about this Toph. She seems like a jerk.
Yeah.
But yeah, I ended up loving all those characters, even like the secondary characters, like May and Ty Lee. They ended up being like a lot of fun.
Yeah.
I really enjoyed it. It took up like a lot of my life when I was watching it. And when I finally finished it, I was like, man, I mean, I know everyone has this feeling when they finish a show that they like, and they're like, what do I do with my life? But like, seriously, I was like, oh man, like, I remember, like, I would come back home for lunch from work, and I would watch an episode or two of Avatar, and I'm just like, I don't want to watch anything if it's not Avatar.
Yeah, it's just nice to come home to, and it's always sad because I can watch the whole show like really quickly, and part of me is always like, oh, I wish there was more, but that's just me because I love it so much. It's the perfect length.
Yeah.
Like it didn't need to be, they knew the story they wanted to tell. And I appreciate that. They were like, yeah, 3 seasons. That's enough. Like it's a short show, but it's intentionally that way because they know the story they wanted to tell and they didn't stretch it too thin. And I love when shows do that. It's so appreciated. Yeah. And they, you know, they didn't try to, you know, add on a filler season of like a bunch of nonsense. They just 3 seasons do your thing.
And it's not like we have Walking Dead.
Yeah, exactly.
Shots fired.
Prime example for that. And yeah, it's just great, and I still really love it. When did you first like hear about the show? Because I know you didn't grow up with it, but did you ever like kind of know about it?
Yeah, I remember seeing like I'd see images and toys of it. Mm. I remember seeing a lot of Appa plush toys.
Oh yeah,
that was a big thing. I would actually get Avatar and Naruto mixed up because I didn't know either of those, but they both have like this little kid in like an orange or red robe.
Yeah,
or
whatever. That's true. Yeah.
So I got those mixed up sometimes.
That's hilarious.
Maybe sometimes thought they were the same thing, but I definitely knew of the, even actually at the time I couldn't tell if he was a kid or not.
With oh, Aang. Right. Yeah.
It was just
bald.
This bald dude with an arrow.
Right.
And then, of course, when the movie came out, that was like a whole, that was kind of like when it was solidified in my head. Okay. Avatar The Last Airbender is a thing.
Yeah.
Like, that's a whole thing that exists. Ugh. It's a show that a lot of people love, and a lot of people hated this movie.
Should we, like, watch the movie
and make an episode about it?
Yeah. I refuse to watch it.
I don't know. I feel like I would hate life.
It would be miserable.
Because, like, I don't, like, this new show that's coming out that's supposed to be live action, I don't want that to happen.
I'm really worried about it. It does have the original creators at least, but I just it seems so unnecessary.
It's just how I feel about
remakes and such.
Like, why fix what ain't broke, you know?
And like the picture they showed of it, it's vague. It's just like a really far shot of Appa and like Aang with his hand on him, but it's like a silhouette basically. But like, it could be cool, but I feel like if they're just going to tell the exact same story, what's the point? If maybe they're going to do something different, it's like that can exist and I'll check it out.
And
but
it's also a thing about,
there's no way they can top this show.
And there's a thing about like animation, like the expressions and like the attitude of all the characters. You're not going to be able to recreate it. And so
exactly,
like, what's the point?
Because with animation, you can create any kind of imagery and have any kind of setting that you can imagine. And with live action, you can still do that with CG, but it's sometimes it looks really fake. It's not believable. You're really limited. And a lot of the time they have to limit like locations. And that's the cool thing about this Last Airbender show is there's so many different areas and places they explore. And I just feel like live action limits the imagination of what animation can do. And the big part of the show is the world building and the environments and the cities and places. And I just feel like a live action show would not be able to do that justice.
Yeah.
And I feel like if the original writers are on it, maybe they can still keep the characters as good as they are. But I just see like remade versions of the characters being really like one dimensional and not as fleshed out. If it can't be better, I don't see the point. If it can at least be its own thing, that's completely its own thing somehow, it's fine. And if, I don't know, I'm always worried about the idea of
if they pulled another Legend of Korra and made just a different story in the same universe.
That's what I wanted them to do. I was kind of just hoping they would keep making like 3-season like shows of like the next Avatar.
That would be interesting.
And like each new show is about the next Avatar, and then because this one, it's like all the people there are like characters from Last Airbender, and then the one, if they made another series, it could be like all the characters from Korra are kind of like older and stuff, and just like keep doing that. I think that would be really cool.
They're
not going to do that, but
yeah, that's the thing. You can only have so many wars for each Avatar,
or like go back in time, do one of the older Avatars that like I don't know, like Roku, a show about Roku could be cool. I mean, they kind of like had an episode about him, so we'd know his life, but just, I don't know, it would be interesting, but it has so much potential to have more series. And even if that's the thing about Korra, even though it's not near as good, it didn't ruin the old characters. It's not trying to replace it. It's just like this new thing with new stuff and characters, and it's cool.
Yeah. It doesn't change anything like, it's not like Star Wars or anything.
Yeah, exactly.
I think you're right. I just, whatever. We have a great show. It's almost perfect.
Yeah.
Doesn't it have like a 99% on Rotten Tomatoes?
Something like that. Yeah.
It's like an almost perfect show.
It's one of the best rated shows. And then I guess the last thing I'll say real quick or ask, do you have a favorite episode? I don't know if even I could think of a favorite one, so don't feel pressured to answer. I'll try to think of one. It's kind of hard to choose a favorite episode from something that's like an ongoing plot. But
yeah, especially since I've only watched them once.
Yeah, and if you only, yeah, it's hard
all
to
the
recall.
Way through. Favorite, I guess I can mention a few.
Or like moments that really stuck out to you, I guess, or like favorite.
Well, nothing that I haven't really mentioned before. Yeah. Like the episode where Appa gets taken away.
Yeah.
And that becomes like really emotional for Aang. I love, well, like the last few episodes in the season are great.
Yeah.
I think when they're trying to defeat the Fire Lord, that's all.
Yeah. I love awesome. I love the invasion. God, I really need to refrain from going on too long, but just a couple, one thing I want to mention is I love how the show is building up to the eclipse thing.
Yeah.
And it's like, we got to do it before the eclipse. And then they finally have the invasion on the eclipse and it just totally fails.
Yeah.
And like this whole, it feels like the whole show they've been building up to this moment and it fails.
Yeah.
And that is just like that. I remember that part being so crazy to me. I was like, oh, like what do they do?
Yeah. I think it was interesting how they like let that happen in a show.
Yeah.
Where like this whole big thing. Because
you really think like
the
climax of the show is going to be the eclipse.
Mm-hmm.
So, but it's totally not.
Yeah. I guess another specific moment that I really loved was, I know I mentioned with like Appa getting taken away from Aang and like Aang being upset, but I really loved the moment where like Aang is just like furious and he's like going in avatar mode or whatever.
Yeah.
And then like Katara comes up to him and is like hugging him.
Yeah.
And then he just like starts crying.
Yeah.
He's like, oh gosh.
So sad.
Yeah, I don't know if I can really think.
I'm trying to think of one too, but I can't really. I can think of like moments in my head, but like a single episode is kind of hard to pick one out.
Yeah. Yeah. I really liked most of like all of season three.
Yeah.
Of them being in that, what's the city that they were in?
I can't remember the name.
Just that big city where like everyone's, hypnotized.
Oh,
and all
yeah.
That. I thought that was super interesting. Yeah. I don't know. There was just a lot that I really liked. And I liked the episodes where Zuko is, did I say that right?
Yeah.
I'm like so tired.
Yeah, Zuko.
Zuko is like starting to turn to and like joining the rest of the gang.
Yeah.
I love it when he reunites with Uncle Iroh.
Yeah.
I already mentioned that one episode that I really loved where it was just him by himself, basically.
Yeah.
That one really stands out to me.
Yeah, that's one of my favorites. And one of my favorite moment is probably like him after betraying Iroh, and when they finally like, you know, make amends and Iroh forgives him and stuff. That's like one of my favorite moments because, just they were like living a nice life with the tea shop and stuff. And then Zuko just ruins it all and just seeing how all that goes to hell. And then he is still forgiven, which is just like weirdly beautiful to me because like the way his father was to him. But he, like, Iroh, even after that.
Oh, yeah, true. Like, any
like,
mess up.
Still, like,
yeah.
Open arms. It's just great.
Yeah.
I think that show has a lot of really, it doesn't, like, shove lessons in your face, but you learn a lot about, like, what's important and how you should be how you should be to people. You learn a lot through character interaction. Like, this is, like, what's good, you know?
Yeah.
And it does it without like spoon, like, hey, like forgiveness is important, and they make it like they have a character. This is, they show it, and it's really effective way to like, I guess, teach kids how to, you know, a lot of important lessons on tolerance with other nations and people of different backgrounds and forgiveness and even like when forgiveness can go too far, like where to draw the line. It's a lot of really important life lessons in that show, but it's still entertaining and intense. And it's just great. This is great, man. I'm really glad you liked it.
Yeah.
It makes me happy.
I'm glad we understand each other more.
And, and it worked out well. We both really liked the shows we watched.
Yeah.
So. Mm-hmm.
Which I wasn't worried about not liking Avatar, really.
Yeah. I think I was just worried you were going to be like, it was okay.
No.
That's all I was worried about. But I'm glad that you said you loved it. So.
Yeah. So there you have it, folks. Avatar, Robin Hood.
Good
That's
stuff.
It. I kind of have, and I've had this idea of what we should talk about next.
Yeah.
Our episode.
Say it.
Since it's like a recent thing going on right now, I think this would be a perfect time to have an episode about this particular musical group, Gorillaz.
Oh yeah.
What if we had an episode about Gorillaz?
Yeah, we need to. I think I suggested that a while ago, but we wanted to do this first. So
I don't even remember.
I think I mentioned it. You're like, let's do the TV episode first, and then I think I mentioned it. It was really brief, but I agree.
Okay, whatever.
We absolutely need to do a Gorillaz episode.
No, yeah, and it would be pretty easy because there's a few albums, and you know,
and we're pretty much on the same page. We have different favorites, but the albums we don't like, and how we well, no, actually, there is going to be some disagreement on some stuff. I think
just little things, yeah,
like yeah,
but I'll save it. Yeah, they're a band that we both like, so I think that would be good. Hey everyone, this is Clifford from the future. So we realized after recording this episode that we had forgotten my recommendation. It was my turn for a recommendation for this episode, and we forgot about it. So I'm editing this now, and I'm recording this right now to give you my recommendation. And my recommendation for this episode is the film Under the Silver Lake. Under the Silver Lake is an A24 film directed by David Robert Mitchell, and it stars Andrew Garfield. Now, I will warn you, Under the Silver Lake is not a film for everyone, because needless to say, it's a really weird film, and so it's not going to be for everyone, but I personally love it. I watched it with some friends via social distancing. We watched it together. I watched it for the second time, and I loved it even more than the first time, because I feel like after rewatching it, I understand a lot more about it. And it's a comedy, but also suspenseful. There's a lot of it's got conspiracy theory stuff in it, but it's just really weird. So if you don't think that you don't that if you're not the type of person that really wants to be challenged a whole lot in a movie, then it's not going to be for you. But if that is for you, I highly recommend it. It's one of my favorite performances from Andrew Garfield, and so that's my recommendation for the week. Okay, back to the rest of the episode. So thanks for listening to this. If you like what you heard, I'm basically just saying what I already have in the pre-recorded outro.
So listen to that.
Yeah.
Here it is.
Stay tuned for that. Love you all. Thank you for listening to the Podwood Forecast.
Stay safe. Stay strong.
Stay healthy.
We know being at home sucks and is mentally draining, but it sucks for a lot of people. But
we're here.
Yeah, we're the saviors.
Yes.
You're doing good. You got this. We love you.
You're doing good.
Good job.
Don't quit. Don't give up. All right. Okay. Bye, everyone.
See you.
Thanks for checking out this episode of the Podwood Forecast. If you liked what you heard, be sure to subscribe. And if you'd like for us to give you a shout out on the show, be sure to leave a rating and review on Apple Podcasts. And also feel free to look in the show notes for links to our social media at Twitter and Facebook. And as always, stay beautiful, and thanks for listening.